The third year of the Rob Scarlatta era kicks off with a blustery day on the hilltop as the Georgetown Hoyas host the Davidson Wildcats in both teams' season opener. Hello, football fans. I'm Jeremy Huber, joined by my color commentators today, Emory Hunt and Michael Niebrick. And guys, football season is here. Mike, we'll start with you. Obviously, you've seen a lot of season openers, a lot of feelings going through these kids' minds right now.
Yeah, there's obviously a lot of nerves always through the first game of the year. So expect these guys to start off a little bit sloppy. But then once you kind of get into the groove of things, it just becomes another football game, and that's where you see guys start to settle down. So always a lot of nerves. It's exciting for them, exciting for us, so should be a good day.
And Emory, of course, Mike mentioned it, you know, some sloppy play. Those are the things as a coach you're kind of worried about coming into a game like this.
You don't want to have those dumb penalties or mistakes or miscues early on in the ball game, but we're going to see probably a little bit of that early on. But coaches don't want to see that. They want a clean game. They prep all summer for this. They're ready to kick this thing off.
And in this matchup today, a battle of quarterbacks. Of course, one a little more experienced than the other. We'll start with Davidson, Michael, and their quarterback, Taylor Mitchell.
Yeah, for Taylor Mitchell, experience is the key. Last year, he played in 10 games. He was a starter in 9 of them, so he has a lot of experience under center. He's looking to build upon last season. He threw for 1,500 yards and 10 touchdowns, so has some experience there, has some numbers. Now he's looking to build upon that. But I think the big thing is who's next for Davidson. They have a couple of freshman guys. Their backups are freshmen, so if you know, something happens with him and he can't go, who's next for the Davidson Wildcats?
Of course, on the other side of things for Georgetown, it's a guy who's really waited his turn, and that would be Tim Barnes.
Tim Barnes, exciting player. Coach Scarlatto is extremely high on this guy, and he's ready to take the reins. He's sat the last 3 years behind Kyle Nolan, their starter. So he's ready to go here, ready to take the reins, ready to step into that leadership role. He's a dual threat guy. Look for him to use his arms, his arm and his legs equally throughout the course of the game. And he's also the number 35 Joe Ekabachi Memorial jersey recipient for this year, which is given to the most exceptional player on Georgetown's team. And it really exemplifies his leadership on and off the field. So exciting player. Like I said, Coach Scarlatto is extremely high on him. So look for him to have a big year and a big day today.
Yeah, and of course, in today's matchup, Davidson comes into this game looking to get a win. Emory, what are some keys to a win for them?
It's about resetting the line of scrimmage on defense. Georgetown wants to come into this ball game and try to own up front. If you can reset the line of scrimmage, it puts you in a positive situation. They also have to win the special teams battle. I believe you only have to win 2 out of the 3 aspects of the game, offense, defense, or special teams. If they can win special teams, it helps them out. And I think overall, it's about stringing together positive offensive plays. They didn't do a lot production-wise last season. Just 1 foot in front of the other could help them win this matchup.
Now let's go ahead and look at some players to watch for this Davidson team. We will start with their safety, Ben Rowell.
And Ben Rowell was a football game plan preseason All-American. Outstanding special teams player as a kickoff returner and punt returner, and also a tremendous safety.
Also today, another player to watch for this team is wide receiver Cam Chevron.
And Chevron is the guy that's the leading receiver coming back. He's a big-time playmaker. If they can get him involved in the game plan early and often, it bodes well for their chances.
And one more player to watch for this Davidson squad. We go to the defensive side of the ball, and defensive end Thomas Sykes.
And Sykes is 6'1", 228. He's a lighter guy, but he has that quickness off the edge. That's evident by those 39 tackles, 4.5 sacks, and 5.5 TFLs. Davidson's going to win this ball game. Sykes is going to have a big day.
Yeah, you're going to see if he can stand up at the point of attack against the Hoyas. Let's switch it over to Georgetown and their keys to the game in this contest. Michael, and some big ones that Coach Scarlatta wanted to see.
A couple of things for the keys to the game here for Georgetown. The first one being tackle in the open field. Obviously, this being the first live game that they've had, you want to make sure that the kids are out there using fundamentals and tackling in the open field. They also want to take care of the football on offense and special teams. One of the things you see a lot of in these first games of the year is sloppy play, some turnovers on offense and the special teams. So Coach Scarlatta really wants his guys to take care of the football there. And they also want to get off to a great start. Last year, a lot of their wins, they took the lead into halftime. Look for them to try and get off to a fast start here and get that lead going into halftime.
Would be huge for the Hoyas to get a win. Of course, players to watch for this Georgetown team, 3 of them as well. We start with a guy we talked about earlier, the quarterback, Tim Barnes.
It all starts with Tim Barnes. He's the quarterback. He's the guy now, as we mentioned earlier, the leader of this team, leader of this offense. Look for him to have a big day.
Also today, one of his main targets on the day, a player to watch in tight end Matt Buckman.
Matt Buckman, another big-time guy for this offense, one of the leaders of this offense. Last year had an outstanding season, very versatile guy that they use in the run and the pass game. So look for him to kind of be on the line of scrimmage, look for him to line up in the slot and make some plays with his feet.
And on the defensive side of things, one of the team captains, David Akiri.
David Akiri, one of the team captains, as you mentioned, had a big year last year. He's been playing since he was a freshman, so a lot of experience in that secondary. Look for him to lead that secondary, lead the defense, and have a big game for Georgetown.
Fourth on the team in tackles last year. Well, had a chance to catch up with both coaches before the game. On the Davidson side of things, our Anna Tarula able to catch up with their head coach, Paul Nichols.
Heading into the first game of the season, what is going to be your team's biggest advantage heading into this game?
Well, I don't know about advantage. I think we've worked very hard in the off season. We've had a great training camp, and I think our kids believe in each other. They believe in our plan, and looking forward to getting after it this afternoon.
Tell me a little bit about practice this past week. What has been the biggest focus?
Well, I tell you that the number one focus has been our special teams, is making sure that anytime it's a first game, it's an area where you can really gain an advantage. And so I think special teams have been important to us this week, and just basic fundamentals. Obviously, in a first game, guys are going to get really excited, and the teams that can really stick to the fundamentals are the teams that usually come out on top.
Thank you, Coach.
Thanks a lot.
And Anna also able to catch up with the head coach of the Georgetown Hoyas with another year on the hilltop. That would be Rob Scarlatta.
Coach, you've got a new starting quarterback in Tim Barnes. What have you said to him this week to prepare him for his new role?
Well, you're lucky when you graduate a kid like Kyle Nolan. And then Tim Barnes has been his backup for 3 years, and he probably could start for three of the teams in the conference. So, with Timmy, I just told him to do what we've been doing since August 7th when we reported, take his time, go through all his progressions, and to be honest with you, I'm super excited to see him play today as a starter.
Definitely. How's he handling the pressure?
I'd say there's any pressure, to be honest with you. We told the kids, do the same thing you would do today as we did all through practice. So game day for us really should be an easier day. We tried to construct our preseason camp that way too, where it was a really difficult physical conditioning type of a camp. So when we got to the game days, hopefully they would be easier.
And what's going to be the biggest challenge that your team faces in this Davidson team today?
They play hard. Coach Nichols has done a great job at Davidson. He's a grad from there, and was a heck of a player himself. So when you watch his teams play on tape, they play snap to whistle, and that's something that we preach to our kids, is we're going to have to match their level of intensity for this game.
Thanks, Coach.
Thank you, Anna, and thank you, Coach. Now time to take a quick look at our starting lineups in this game. We start with Georgetown, Michael, and of course we talked about Tim Barnes, but some other guys to watch in this one, including the running back, Alex Vallis.
Yeah, I definitely want to pay attention to the running back core for Georgetown. This is one of Coach Scarlatta's deepest running back cores. He's very excited about what these guys bring to the table. So look for them to kind of establish a running game early and use those guys throughout the course of the game.
And those receivers, we know you like some good receivers. They got some experienced ones in Hill, Harrell, and also Matt Buckman, the tight end. Also starting lineups today on the Georgetown side of things on defense. Again, a lot of defensive line coming back. I actually talked ahead to defensive line coach Alex Colter earlier in the booth, and it seems like he's really kind of happy with what he's got back on the defensive line.
Yeah, the defensive line is probably one of their deepest spots throughout the defense, but I really want to actually pay attention to their outside linebacker, Dan Yankovic. He led second in the team in tackles last year. Expect him to have a big season this year for the Hoyas.
Yeah, Yankovic, former special teams maven, has really made a good transition to the outside linebacker spot. And of course, Davidson, their starting lineup as well on the defensive side of things. And we mentioned Ben Rowell, really a good guy there. Emory, anybody else that catches your eye?
Well, you look at Boo Jordan. A lot of attention will be paid to Thomas Sykes and what he can do as a pass rusher. So that's going to open up a lot of opportunities for Boo Jordan to make his name known to a lot of guys around the FCS in this ball game. So I'm looking forward to seeing how he responds to getting a lot of single coverage.
And on the offensive side for Davidson, that starting lineup as well, some interesting things there. Of course, we talked about Taylor Mitchell, the quarterback. Another guy to watch out for, the running back, Austin Wells.
And Wells is a guy that's going to have to he's going to have to provide this balance for this offense. And also, you look at Travis Stubblefield, the center. If you want to dominate up front, it starts with center play. That's the most important position on the offensive line, in my opinion.
Yeah, again, see what they can do. And, of course, Wells, interesting note on him, really did not play a lot last year due to injuries. His numbers are a little bit down, but really they're looking for some good things from Austin Wells this year. Well, of course, the Hoyas are on the field. Davidson out there as well, almost ready for our national anthem. and, of course, Georgetown. A lot of excitement about this team. Really, guys, they've brought back a lot. There's a lot of guys back, and really I think it's one of those teams that Rob Scarlatta, you know, maybe a breakthrough year for the Hoyas could be on the table. But, of course, Michael, it probably has to come, as you said, through the quarterback play of Tim Barnes. He's got to be really effective for them to be well this year.
Exactly. It's going to start and end with Tim Barnes. What he can do leading the team, what he can do on the offensive side of the ball. So he's got a lot of guys coming back. Coach Scarlatta is extremely pleased with how this team has done throughout the offseason. Look for them to make a big step here this year.
And Emory, of course, on the other side of things, this team with Georgetown, again, a lot of other things. But the defense, again, we saw it last year, really good as the season or the games went on. They've got to be good starting off.
Yeah, their front seven is going to be outstanding. You look at Navaki, you look at Sawicki, you also look at Lockery. Those guys do a great job in just smothering an offense. I think they're going to be able to play a huge role in the outcome of this game and also for the duration of the season.
Well, our colors are being moved to midfield as we're almost ready for our national anthem here as the Hoya is all standing at attention, and, of course, Davidson as well. So we'll take a quick break as we bring you the national anthem and football coming up right after this.
Ladies and gentlemen, please remain standing for the singing of our national anthem by junior defensive lineman number 95, Elijah English.
Defensive end Elijah English with our national anthem. We are almost ready for football. For those of you watching our pregame coverage on social media, we invite you to join us for our full game broadcast at campusinsiders.com. Well, folks, almost ready to get this one going. And again, the captains will take to midfield for the coin toss. And of course, you saw the flags there. And it was really, it's the wind has been kicking up a little bit so far in this game. And Mike, again, you're a guy who's played here on this field, and one of the things that Emory and I have remarked about a little bit throughout the years is the way this field is set up throughout the buildings of the Georgetown campus. You've got these little pockets of, you know, wind tunnels almost coming through. Is that something that can affect the quarterbacks, considering you're not getting a true wind maybe as you go from the 20 to the other 20?
It's definitely something that's going to affect both guys. I know just being up in the booth, we've had a couple of different gusts coming from different directions. So usually at most fields, you have one direction that the wind's coming in the whole time, which is easy to kind of plan, as you're moving up and down the field. Today it's going to be a little bit difficult. They're going to have to kind of play it by ear.
Yep, and of course, we'll see what they're able to do. Of course, you see a shot out there. Ty Williams, of course, suffered the spinal cord injury last year. He is a captain today with the Hoyas, doing such a great job in his rehab, of course, alongside the rest of the captains. Looks like right now that he toss won by Davidson. I believe they have deferred, of course, as you see that group out there. David Akiri out there with Tim Barnes as well, and Casey Coons as well. So we will go ahead and get this one underway as the Hoyas will go ahead and receive, I believe. So, again, Ty Williams, a really good story there, is what he's been able to do since his injury last year against St. Francis in the season opener. So really a year through, and we'll hear, we'll hear from Ty later on in the broadcast. So, again, good to see him and Rob Scarlotta giving a big hug. Of course, he's been there for Ty throughout. So really good to see him out here, and good to see him getting love from his team. And, of course, you see the guy who's pushing him along there, his teammate Tim Barnes, of course, wearing the Joe Akabachi jersey this year. Michael referred to a little bit, of course, Joe Akabachi, former Hoya football player that passed away in the 9/11 attacks, of course, in this jersey, a living memorial each year to a player that really exemplifies all the qualities they want a Georgetown football player. And Barnes is a guy who's been able to do that. And, you know, Michael, you know this. It's tough to be out there and to sit and not play. And, again, he's been able to be a positive member of this team without getting playing time. Got to be a tough thing to do, but he's done it well.
It's a very difficult thing to do, especially, you know, a lot of guys coming out of high school with those egos. They come into college and they want to play right away. It's very tough to be able to just kind of fight through the years of sitting behind a guy, especially a guy like Kyle Nolan, who did so well for this team. So he's excited for this opportunity, excited to get this second start under his belt and lead this team throughout the course of the season.
Almost ready for football here at Georgetown as Ben Pretty will tee it up. Back deep will be Ben Rao, lone return man for Davidson. Hoyas in the navy blue with the silver helmets today. Davidson in the all white with the black helmets. Ball comes off the tee, and early on we're seeing the wind playing some tricks.
Week one mistakes. We just talked about it. You know, even the weather is not cooperating. Not ready for football.
Tell you what, though, really nice day out here. It's good football weather. A little bit humid, but the temperature is in the 70s. I'm sure that's about the way you would draw it up. And now it looks like they'll have a holder come in and put this one down the tee. Jake Johnson, one of the starting corners, will come out and hold as Pretty will go ahead and kick this one off. Pretty on the season last year, just two touchbacks. So, again, we'll see what he's able to do. He'll be kicking with the wind as the flags on the goalposts going that way. But as we mentioned, it can swirl a little bit in here considering the crazy wind patterns. I'm going to talk about all the buildings in the area. So Pretty has it teed up. It's being held. And we are underway as the Hoyas kick off their season. Rao going to take it just outside his goal line. A little bit of a seam. Rao, big returner. Flag goes down. He'll take it out to the 25-yard line, but that should come back.
And he's a big guy, 5'10", 211, so that's not your average safety who's running back that kick. That's a guy that's built like a running back and doing a good job in doing so.
But just like you mentioned, Emory, early on, a flag on the first play. Something that, hey, hopefully the Davidson coaches are sitting there thinking, hey, hopefully that's just, we're getting it out of the way early.
Get them out early, get them out the way early, and play a clean game throughout.
So it'll be a flag on the play, a hold, and that will move the ball back to the 11-yard line. So Davidson will scrimmage from there. First and 10. Of course, last year, Davidson 2-9, 1-7 in the Pioneer League. Hoyas a 4-7 mark, 2-4 in the Patriot League. 2-3 at home, 2-4 away. Hand off tackle, trying to get to the outside, and nothing doing for the running back Austin Wells as Javion Butler makes a nice play to start things off for the Hoyas.
Yeah, good job right there, getting off a block and making a play in space. If you're going to play winning defense, perimeter defense is going to be key in this game.
We're told Daniel Yankovic would go ahead and start this game. He is on the sidelines, though, as Javion Butler started, and see it there, great play.
Yeah, great job from penetrating through the line of scrimmage, getting up past his guy on the offensive line and making the play.
So now a second, we'll call it 16, all the way back at the 5-yard line with Mitchell in the gun. Looking long, now he'll check it down, and Hoyas there with good pursuit, getting to the spot. Jethro Francois, the first hit, as it's a gain of four.
And that's what we talked about in the open, is about building off positive plays. That's the positive play right there. That's a five-yard gain. Now, you don't want the loss that we saw on first down, but if Davidson can string together plays like this, again, it just builds that confidence that they'll need moving forward.
And the tricky part here, you know, being the first game, first drive of the season, is now you're in a 3rd-and-10 situation. So you want to make sure, like we mentioned, take care of the football if you're Taylor Mitchell.
Hoyas with some substitutions. Pass rushers Novacki and Kislik at the ends. They're going hunting right now. Shotgun again. Blitz coming. They get out of it. Screen pass. Maybe a big gainer here. And it'll be first down yardage. So a perfect play call by Davidson as they get it out to the wide receiver. And Gibson Bornelius, the running back. And he ends up getting a gain of 12.
Yeah, what a great play call right there. The screen saw the blitz come. And he did a good job in not throwing that screen too early. He waited, he was patient, and it was perfectly placed and ended up being a first down.
Yeah, he did a really nice job just taking his drop, baiting the defenders to come to him and dumping it off, delivering a good throw, a nice catchable ball that he can catch and just make a play like he did.
Right into the blitz, Blaze Brown coming, the spot vacated, and Davidson able to get it. Now, Bornelius going to cut it all the way back. He'll be hit and brought down as Akiri comes up from the safety spot to limit him to a 3-yard gain.
Yeah, Akiri came from all the way across the field to make that play. Shows his effort and his hustle to bring down Bornelius, for a short gain.
Gibson Bornelius, the junior out of Fort Myers, Florida, he's listed at just 161. Mentioned earlier, their safety looks like a running back. Their running back looks like a cornerback. Slant pattern, that'll be caught. Another completion for Davidson, a gain of 13 yards on the play as Braden Sims put the catch on the slant pass.
Really nice job there by Mitchell, just taking what the defense gave him. He had off coverage to the boundary, had a slot to him. Take it, quick step drop, deliver a catchable ball. Good job there by Mitchell.
And it was a good job of anticipation, too. That ball was out of his hands before the receiver even got out of his break, and it ended up hitting him right in the numbers. Positive plays, and now look at this. They're right marching in the right direction at the 41-yard line.
Wildcats send a trip set out to the right of quarterback Taylor Mitchell out of Buford, Georgia. Boy, his show blitz. I'll give it off to Bornelius. He'll be hit and brought down, but not till a gain of 4, maybe 5 on the play.
And you see Akiri there just coming up from his safety spot, making another play. We mentioned earlier that he was the captain of this team, captain of the defense, got a lot of experience under his belt. So good job there by him.
And a rarity in college football nowadays is a huddle, team being patient. You know, I saw a game last night where guys were just running full speed, up-tempo, no huddle, and now we see a calm play call. Get everybody in the right position, run the play, and be effective.
Yeah, like you said, see so much of that hurry-up spread nowadays trying to catch the defense off guard. Davidson just doing it the old-fashioned way. Now a quarterback run here, a little bit of room, hit and brought down after a gain of 2 is the QB Mitchell as he moves the chains along a bit but still be facing a 3rd down and 4 here.
Empty set there for the Wildcats, just a designed run play, simple run play for Mitchell. Not the greatest runner, straight line speed, but he can get you those tough yardage when you need him.
3rd manageable midfield. I know it's the first quarter, first drive, but you could also be looking at maybe a 2-down territory here.
Yeah, and these are definitely the 3rd downs that you want to start a game early on in the season.
Mitchell comes from an athletic family. Dad played college football. Mom played college basketball. He'll look for the 3rd and 3 here. Offset eye formation. Fake the handoff. Looking in the flat. He'll be hit, and it'll be caught. So an amazing play as Butler comes and makes the big hit, but somehow ends up being caught by the wide receiver as Sims makes another play and moves the sticks.
Great heady play right there. There's a couple things to look at. First, you have a fullback in the backfield. I like that. Second, good play action call on 3rd and short. And the right read was made. Good hit over by Javion Butler. And heads up play by the receiver making the catch.
Looks like a poozy fell in coverage there. Might have been there for a pick. Instead, it's a 1st down for the Wildcats as they have it moving after starting inside their own 10-yard line. Bornelius trying to bounce to the outside. He'll be hit and brought down, still on his feet. Now he goes down. First hit came from Hunter Kislik. Then it was Leo Lockery cleaning him up.
And that was a great job there by Hunter Kislik, just forcing the play outside, forcing the running back to bounce it out here. as we see here, just pushes that tackle out, forces the running back to bounce it, and makes a good play getting off the block.
Yeah, you never like to see that as a running back, someone that's a defensive lineman flashing in front of your face first. You panic in a sense, and that's what led to that big loss right there for Davidson.
Hunter Kislick, the fifth year out of Nutley, New Jersey, always seems to have a knack for big plays, helps make one there. Second and 20, this one out in the flat will be caught, and getting some of that yardage back will be Jarris Scott. Still third and long here for Davidson.
I really like what the Wildcats did there with that play call, though. Taylor Mitchell has found a rhythm early on here throwing the football. They use that play to just get 10 yards back, and now kind of like Emory alluded to earlier in the drive, this is four down territory, I think. You're past the 50-yard line. It's third and 12. Get half of it here, and then get the rest on fourth down.
And he's looked well, you know, so far in this game. I like what I'm seeing from him.
Mitchell and Bornelius again in the shotgun formation. Over the middle, this will be complete again, and another big gain for Davidson all the way down to the 20-yard line. And again, guess who? It's Braden Sims.
And it's nothing fancy on this. This was four verticals down the side. You pick which one had the best coverage, and he found the guy right down the hash, hit him in stride. And you have to be honest, Mitchell is playing with a lot of confidence right now despite taking that hit, and is just making great decisions with the football.
Yeah, as you see, this saw there, just a cover four defense, a little switch route on that backside there, gave the cornerback a little bit of a mix-up, and Mitchell just found him right down the seam. Great throw. Like I said, he found a rhythm here early on.
So Davidson looking to finish off a big drive, started at their own 10-yard line after the penalty, now throughout in the flat, and again, big play by Javion Butler. Tried to hit Derek Jones out there, and Butler was Johnny on the spot.
And Butler is not a big guy, so to speak. He's 6'2", 205. He's built more like a safety. He's playing linebacker in this defense, but he's an excellent open field tackler. We've seen him already on his drive with two TFLs and one right there on a big stick.
Yeah, even though Davidson's they're moving down the field, he's made a couple of really big plays here in this drive. He's been all over the field for the Hoya defense. He had that big hit on that lucky
back there,
kind of third down play that was caught. So he's been all over the field for the Hoya defense here, and you got to like that if you're Rob Scarlatta.
Davidson going to have to take a timeout here as the play clock ran low, as the head coach of the Davidson Wildcats, Paul Nichols, had to go ahead and get that in. Again, had a chance earlier today. Of course, want to talk about Ty Williams and, of course, the spinal cord injury we addressed it earlier on. Again, happened in this game as against St. Francis last year. You see the play and just a normal hit. And, was not a good day for the Hoyas there as, Ty Williams just making a regular play there. And sometimes, again, in this game of football, sometimes these things happen. But, again, Ty has made such great strides since that day. And again, before the game, our Anna Tarullo had a chance to catch up with Ty Williams.
Ty, what's going through your mind being back here out on this field for a season opener today?
It's nice to be back. You know, I'm just ready here, ready for a win, you know.
Big day for the guys.
They're ready for it. I'm ready for it, you know.
So a lot of people have described you as just an overwhelmingly positive guy. What motivates you to remain so positive?
You know, you just kind of got to be positive in this situation. So, you know, I got a good support system behind me, great support system actually, so it's easy.
What does this Georgetown team and the community mean to you in your recovery?
Oh, it means the world. They've been behind me since day one, and just knowing that, I mean, it really shows that I picked the right place when I decided to come to school here.
Definitely. Thank you, Ty.
Anna with Ty Williams. Quick pass out in the flat, and a play Ty would be very proud of right there, as it's a quick screen pass out in the flat. Williams Wicks with the catch, and you see Ty again. And of course, you know, just such strong mental to go through a situation like that, and again, keep his spirits up like he has.
And having a positive attitude and good spirits is what's going to get you through any, you know, bout of adversity. He's done a great job so far, and you could just see the smile on his face. He's enjoying being out here.
Doing a great job with his rehab as well, and glad to see him out here with his team. And of course, his defense right now looking at a third and 11, trying to make a stop after giving up a few long third down conversions. Pass out in the flat, hit and brought down short of the sticks. That went out to Jarris Scott, so a positive gain, but not enough to get to the sticks, so the Hoyas defense holds when they need to.
And again, if you're Davidson, you're looking at, hey, we got a positive drive, we made some big plays, we showed we can throw the football, and now we're trying to get points out of this drive. And good job by Right, Mitchell, seeing that late bail by the cornerback and knowing he had the option to go to the outside.
Blaze Brown in on that tackle. So Trevor Smith will come on to kick the field goal. This one marked down at the 24. Kick is up, but it is going to veer and hit the goalpost. So Davidson, the nice drive ends in zeros as the Hoyas defense not only prevents the touchdown, they prevent all points.
And that was a huge win there for that Hoya defense. They'd given up a couple of big third downs, a couple of long third downs. They couldn't get off the field early on. They finally got off the field on that last third down there, and now they force a missed kick and give up no points. So a big win there for the Hoya defense.
And what changed on that those last two plays was we saw the Hoyas finally press on the outside, which makes the things a little bit tougher for the receivers and for the passing game as a whole.
Tim Barnes out on the field. Of course, his first start since his freshman year back in 2013. We'll get back into that in just a bit. An interesting story with our broadcast crew today. He'll hand off to Alex Vallis up the middle, and Vallis stopped after a short game.
Yeah, look for Tim Barnes here to use his legs early and often. He's a big-time dual-threat guy, but he knows how to use his arm as well, so look for him to stay very balanced here throughout this first drive.
Give him a gain of 1.5. Hoya's got to take it out to the 30 for a first down. Barnes, pressured. He'll just throw it into the dirt. Was trying to set up the screen pass to Alex Vallis, and again, not much there. Of course, we talked about Tim's first start since his freshman year. Of course, we've got a little bit of footage of that one as you see some of the plays made by Tim Barnes on that day. And, of course, Barnes, again, in that game was up against our Michael Niebrick, who had a very good game for Fordham that day.
Yeah, Tim Barnes started in that game. It was a little bit one-sided on our side, but he played very well for a freshman. So, look, he's been building on that since that day.
Let's see what he can do here on third and long. And it will be overshot as he was looking for Justin Harrell. Had him open, but just couldn't find the range, and the Hoyas will have to punt it away.
And that goes to what you talked about earlier, Mike, about, you know, the jitters, the nerves, the butterflies, and he was wide open. That was just an errant pass, but you also want to see the receiver give a little bit more effort going up to get it because unimpeded errant passes could end up being picked off.
Yeah, like you said, a little bit of nerves here. His feet are a little bit erratic in the pocket, which is that sign of a young, or actually an old quarterback, but now his second start, it's a sign that he is a little bit nervous. He's going to calm down. He is a senior. He's done this before. So look for him to settle down here as we get further into the game.
Harry McCollum on to punt. High kick. Going to send Rao back inside his 25-yard line. Takes a Davidson bounce, but goes out of bounds. But Harry McCollum gets a big high five from his head coach, Rob Scarlatta, happy with that kick.
Yeah, kicking game matters, man. We just saw it for Davidson miss a field goal. Now we get a great punt by Georgetown, which backs up this Davidson offense. Can they do it a second time around? We shall see.
Can the Hoyas come into this game looking to improve on their 4-7 record last year? Of course, that one could have been much different, as Emory and I called a few of those late games against really the two best teams in the Patriot League in Fordham and Colgate down to the last possession games.
And defensively, again, this is a team that was young last year. They're much more experienced, and you can see that as evident with the play of their front seven.
So Mitchell back out for his second drive of the game. Hand off on the jet sweep, and he'll try and get up and throw a block, but nothing doing there, as brought down was Bornelius, who was out in the slot and came around to get the ball. Yep. Bornelius really getting a lot of the carries early on, not listed as a starter, but they're trying to give him the ball.
And they're trying to set the tone up front. Again, who can win the battle in the trenches is going to determine the winner of this game, and right now Davidson is trying to impose their will on both sides of the ball up front.
Red situation again for Mitchell. Low snap. He'll pick it up, though. Throw it out in the flat. Actually makes something out of it. Ended up getting it over to Chevron, who'll get a positive gain of around 5 on the play.
Yeah, and that right there is just a play of showing off his experience. We alluded to earlier that he started in 9 games last year, played in 10 games. He's got a lot of experience at that quarterback position. Right there, bad snap. Just makes something out of nothing there with his arm. Does a good job at not turning a bad play into something even worse.
And he didn't panic, man. He just calmly picked that ball up and found the open guy. Again, that leadership, like you talked about in the open, is just showing itself here in this first quarter.
So third and we'll call it 4. See 5 on the play. Got to take it up to the 38 for a first down. They'll get that and more as Bornelis, again, the weapon for the Davidson Wildcats. Another big gain all the way across the 50-yard line. Give him a gain of around 20 on the play, and Bornelis really standing out early.
That was a nice play design by Davidson there. Everybody on the left side of the field, they motion over, they leak their running back out into that flat area. Nobody picks him up. Good throw, good run after the catch.
A nice subtle chip, as we like to call it, or a pick, as the defenders like to call it, by that tight. That motion guy knocked off that defender and was able to allow the running back to get free.
Another first down for Davidson, moving the ball well again. Bornelis this time on the handoff. Off right tackle will be hit and brought down. We'll give him a gain of 2 on the play.
And Georgetown's done a really nice job in these first two drives here at stopping the run game of Davidson, but now they need to tighten up a little bit in that secondary. So we'll see if they make adjustments here on the sideline as the course of the game goes on, and see if they can tighten down a little bit as a defense as a whole.
I like the calmness and patience that we're seeing Davidson play with. It seems as if this is their 10th game of the season, and they look calm and composed on the onset.
Pistol formation here for Davidson. Bornelis again up the middle. Now he'll bounce it using that speed to get to the outside. He'll be near the sticks again. Hit and knocked out of bounds by Jelani Williamson. Maybe just short. But again, this guy a weapon. We weren't expecting him to play this much. Wasn't listed as a starter, but boy, he's looking really good.
Yeah, he must have shown something to the coaches throughout the course of this week after the depth charts came out. Did a really nice job there, pressing the line of scrimmage and bouncing it outside where nobody was and getting the yards that he could.
Seems like early on they're trying to spread out the Hoyas and give him some places to run, and he's taking advantage. So now they swap up the running backs. Mitchell under center. And now some movement up front. We'll see who this goes on. They'll say a false start on Davidson, so that'll move them back and really make this a different scenario.
And you know what's giving Georgetown issues right now is the formations that we're seeing from Davidson. One, they utilize an in-the-line tight end. Two, you see an H-back. And three, you see a fullback. So when you're going against a 3-4 defense, you're going to put a lot of pressure on those outside linebackers who just want to get upfield, rush the passer. But now they have to get off blocks. And if you're Davidson, you have the best of both worlds. You have guys that can catch that's in line. Also, you have the freedom to run left or right because you have that power personnel on the field.
Davidson will swap it up as they remove Brown, who was in it running back. They'll bring Bornelis back in and go 5 wide receivers with Mitchell in the gun. Looking over the middle, catch will be made, but short of the sticks is a nice play made by Apuzzi. Came up, hit his man right as he made the catch and keeps Isaiah Anthony from getting to the sticks.
Great job there by Apuzzi, knowing where the sticks were, knowing he had his guy man-to-man, sees him right there in the flat, breaks outwards, like I said, knows where the sticks are, makes a tackle before he can get that first down. So great job there, and sure tackling, as we mentioned, was one of the big keys coming into this game for Georgetown. A great tackle there by him as well.
Under 2 minutes to go in the first quarter, and Davidson looks like they're going to go for it. Bornelis, the 160-pounder, will be in there at running back. Hoyas puts a man up front. They're going to run the option here, looking for the pitch, and it will be stopped. Great play again, and Javion Butler, he didn't make the tackle, but he was right there on the pitch, man. Mitchell had nowhere to go.
I mean, that load option was an outstanding call, but you have to make that pitch. That was right there, one-on-one with your outstanding tailback versus an outside linebacker. Right there, boom, pitch the ball to the running back, let him make one miss and get the first down.
Yeah, Javion Butler made a great play there, extending the pitch out, which is why he didn't pitch the football to begin with. He didn't really feel a commitment there from Butler, and that's why he tried to turn it upfield. A great job by him forcing that play up.
Hugh Masterson and that Hoya defense doing some good things. Now the Hoyas have the ball back with momentum as Barnes, back out there. He'll hand off to Ellsworth, trying to get to the outside. He'll be hit and brought down, and one of the guys we focused on early in the game, Thomas Sykes, showing some speed there. And now a little bit of pushing and shoving down there. They'll separate them quickly, but again, Sykes getting out there from his defensive end spot.
Yeah, Sykes, like you mentioned, just playing that end spot, extending the play, following the read. Once the ball was handed off to that running back, he just followed him outside. Unfortunately, he didn't have a space to turn up early enough, which allowed him to get back into the play.
And outside linebacker Nate Casey helped hold contain on the outside, force that play back in.
Second and 8. Quick pass to Harrell, trying to get to the outside. It'll be hit and brought down. Thought the ball might have come loose for a second. Helmet came off on the tackler. And officials will stop the clock. Now they'll go ahead and wind it. And we'll see if the Hoya is actually trying to get this play off there. Just, I think, going to let this go.
I like that play from Georgetown, though. Just getting a quick pass out for Barnes, trying to get a rhythm going.
And that'll bring us to the end of the first quarter. Georgetown facing a third down when we come back on CampusInsiders.com.
In the Patriot League, our playbooks look a little different. Here, we play to win in the field, in the classroom, and in the community. A competitive athletic experience with high academic standards. Today's scholar athlete, tomorrow's leaders. That's the Patriot League.
Welcome back in. You see the Thompson Center, of course, the wonderful building here on campus. And now the Hoya is back at it, and Tim Barnes showing off his foot speed. He'll be very close to the first down. And again, that was one of the things they say, Mike, he's a true dual threat.
True dual threat guy there. He showed it right there on that third down play. Great job just getting the first down and getting this offense moving now. Hopefully they can establish a rhythm.
Now Hoya is trying to go with pace. Barnes pushing them along, gets it out to Hill in the flat, gets a block by Harrell. He'll be knocked out of bounds, but another good gain of five on the play.
And again, just another short throw to try and get Barnes into a rhythm, speeding up the pace, which will help the offense get into a rhythm as a whole as well.
Quick pace here for the Hoyas. He'll slow it down for just a second. As Barnes again checking out the defense. Slowing down the pace just a little bit here. He'll hand off to Vallis, soft right tackle, and first down yardage for the Hoyas. Let's get it down to our Anna Tarullo.
Sophomore safety Jethro Francois was just sitting over on the trainer's table, icing what appeared to be his right eye head area. I asked the trainers for an injury update. They said they couldn't tell me anything. He's no longer on the table, and we do not have an update whether or not he'll return to the game.
Thank you, Anna. First and 10 for the Hoyas. Barnes, again out in the flat, looking for Hill, and Hill showing some sticky hands there to bring that one in.
Yeah, I mean, you have to like that. That was a confidence throw right there by Barnes. I mean, he's planted his feet and fired a football directly into the numbers of the receiver. Great catch and a great play on first down.
Yeah, definitely a confidence throw, like you just mentioned. Did a really nice job at setting his feet and delivered a good, accurate football with some speed to it, which is a good sign that his confidence is building.
Game slowing down for him.
Barnes with three receivers to his left. He'll again get it out quick to Vallis. Got some room to run. Alex cuts it back. He'll be hit and brought down at the 20-yard line. But now the rhythm going over to the Georgetown quarterback as, again, the Hoyas are moving.
And they're working these guys east to west. They're going downhill, and you see this when you spread the field, you put a lot of pressure on the opposing team's perimeter defense.
Again, fast pace here for the Hoyas. Barnes pump fakes. Now he'll run with it, trying to get to the corner. He's got to get by Rao. He'll be brought down, but close to the sticks, and he will have it. And again, that's those legs that Barnes possesses really hurting Davidson.
Really nice job there by Barnes. Took his drop, stepped up in the pocket, saw all of his guys recovered, and used his legs to pick up a big gain.
Vallis will cut it back. He'll be hit and brought down. And first player there on the scene was Corey Coppola, the defensive end.
And we talked about this off air, how tempo can frustrate defensive coordinators. And it's just about getting lined up. You get lined up and just hope your guys can make a play.
Second and goal, so a short gain there. Hoyas, little bit of a danger zone here when they always tough, kind of trying to get that first and goal from out near the 10-yard line. But a little more space to work with. Harrell goes in motion. Barnes looking to his right. That'll be knocked down. Possible dangerous throw there, getting in the cornerback on the play, Ryan Woods.
Definitely a dangerous throw there by Barnes. A lot of bodies in a tight space. And this is one of the things that you see spread offenses struggle with. Once they get inside that 10-yard line, they don't have that space to use their playmakers to just run around and make plays. Now it becomes a tighter zone, a tighter field to work, and it makes it a little bit trickier to move the football.
Player down on the field for Davidson. Appears that is the linebacker, Nate Casey. And good to see him up.
And he's played some good ball so far in this ball game, just from a technique standpoint, setting the edge, being active in pursuit. And all those things help this defense become very good versus the run and also versus the pass.
41 tackles on the year for Casey last year, the 5'9", 205-pound senior out of Tiga K, South Carolina.
Big play here for this Hoya offense. Third down from the 7-yard line. What are they going to do to try and get the ball these 7 yards?
So Barnes, three receivers to his right, one to his left. That's Brandon Williams. Barnes sticking in, throws across the middle. He has a touchdown. Justin Hill clears through the defense and puts the Hoyas on the board.
Great play design right there. You saw what happened when they snuck the running back out in the flat. It allowed that defensive end to peel back on his pressure, which gave Barnes the time to find an open crosser in the middle of the end zone.
Yeah, it was a great play design right here. You see the running back, Vallis, just leak out to the right. You see the linebackers flow with him, thinking that they're going to try and outflank the defense. Hill sneaks in behind. Great play design, great throw by Barnes, great drive by that Hoya offense.
And the Hoya is able to add the extra point as Henry Darmstadter able to knock it through. And after Davidson put together a few good drives, Tim Barnes finds rhythm. The Hoyas look really good there.
Yeah, and it all started with those short passes early on in the drive. As we saw that first drive, they were a little bit off. Barnes was a little bit nervous. They used those short passes early on to get Barnes into a rhythm. And then they used that up-tempo offense to get the whole offense into a rhythm as well. Really nice drive there by the Hoyas.
And you saw his confidence grow with each and every positive play. And again, it's about stringing together positive plays for an offense, especially in week one. And you saw on that touchdown, his feet were active in the pocket, but it wasn't a panic type active. It was an active to where I'm confident in my decision and I'm gonna make the right throw, and it ends up being a touchdown.
And really, talking to Rob Scarlatta, you could just feel the confidence that he has in Tim Barnes, what this guy can do. And it's, we've seen it before in college football. I mean, I think the most famous example is T. Martin coming in for Peyton Manning after sitting for so many years. You know, sometimes you can get those mental reps, and that was a big point that Coach Scarlatta made to us was, look, you know, it wasn't like he was just kind of sitting there doing nothing. He was sitting there taking mental reps, actually, you know, going through everything so when he got his chance, he'd be ready, and he looked ready right now.
And the big key to what you just said is taking the mental reps. We alluded to earlier how it's very difficult for guys to sit on the bench when they're used to playing so often. So a lot of guys, they kind of check out mentally, which is why you see a lot of kids transfer. You see a lot of kids when they get older, they don't get that playing time. Barnes has done a great job these last 3 years at taking mental reps behind Kyle Nolan, and now it's showing on the field.
Be ready so you don't have to get ready, and that's the biggest mantra you have to have as a football player.
59-yard, 11-play drive. The Hoyas put it in just under 4 minutes and take the 7-0 lead. Rao going to look for a big play here to spark Davidson, and he will be hit, spins off, and eventually brought down. And again, Hoya is doing a pretty good job covering that kick.
Stay in your lane. That's a motto that is spread throughout throughout life, but on kickoff coverage is more important. Otherwise, you're giving up a big return. He did a great job right there, staying in their lane and getting Rowell on the ground.
And we alluded to earlier how they wanted to protect the ball on offense and special teams. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean on special teams that it's just about the kick return and the punt return. Covering your lanes is protecting that football. You don't want a big play to happen right there. If a big play happens for Davidson, the entire momentum shifts. So a good job there by the kickoff team.
So, again, Mitchell will bring them out, the junior out of Buford, Georgia. Threw for 11 touchdowns, 11 interceptions last year. And Bornelas this time will be hit and brought down. And Emory, you know, as an old running back, that is not a good thing to do. Stop and let that pursuit get to you.
Absolutely not, especially when you're running a good play. One of my favorite plays is that power play. You have two offensive linemen leading you around the end. That to be all the way out the gate, but you stop your feet and try to redirect against flow, you're going to lose yards every time.
But a really good job there by Georgetown linebackers coming up, reading the play, and stuffing the hole, not giving him anywhere to make a cut.
Bornelas has really played most of the game at running back. He leaves as the Wildcats go five wides with Mitchell, the lone man in the gun. Wells goes in motion. Keeper by Mitchell. He'll be hit by Kendall, catching and brought down as the big man right there for the stop after a gain of one.
Yeah, I don't know if Mitchell had a point to make right there. You don't want to cut it right back into the arms of a defensive lineman. That was, you know, you want to make a better decision than that. But the play was there for him to have success, but he made a cutback. But great job by the defensive lineman, you know, strafing down the line of scrimmage and making the play.
Yeah, actually, right there is what you just said is the key to the play. He strafed down the line of scrimmage. So Mitchell actually made the right read on the defensive end, but because he strafed down the line, as soon as he pulled that ball, he stepped right up into him.
Third and nine here. Need to get it out to the 34 for a first down. Mitchell looking long, and he'll be incomplete as he was trying to get it to Derek Jones. But good coverage there by Blaze Brown. And after some early shakiness by the Hoyas, the defense looking pretty good.
Again, their front seven is playing some great football right now. But we knew this coming into the ballgame. That's where their strengths lie. And they're matching the intensity up front that Davidson is showing with their offensive line.
Yeah, we mentioned earlier that their front seven was doing a really nice job stopping the run and that they had to come to the sideline and make an adjustment to stop the pass, and that's what you just saw on that drive.
So Michael Matthews on, low snap. Will he get it off? He does, as there was some pressure from the Hoyas. Now kind of that loose ball situation. Apuzzi almost gets hit by the ball, but he got the call from his return man and got out of the way just in time, and the Hoyas now with some pretty good field position.
No panic in the punter. Again, we're not seeing either team panic. And a lot of times you see guys in the first game, those jitters, a lot of panic happens, and that's where you get those bonehead plays. But we haven't seen that. We had a couple of missed snaps, but both teams were able to calmly pick the ball up and make positive things happen. That's a testament to both coaching staffs.
Definitely a testament to both coaching staffs, and it also shows the experience on both sides of the ball. Both of these teams have a lot of juniors and seniors who have played a lot of football, so they know what to do in those situations.
Looked like sophomore linebacker Chris Gavin was the guy that came back there once Mitchell had trouble with the punt. Ellsworth trying to string to the outside. He'll be hit and brought down after a gain of three.
It's a great play by right there by Matthew Buckman, getting that block that allowed the back to get through that lane and pick up 3 yards.
So Ellsworth and Vallis, the top two on the depth chart, though the coaching staff did say keep an eye out for Christian Bermudez and also Carl Thomas, two younger guys that they like. Ellsworth will take it off left tackle, and again, a short gain out to the 50, so the Hoyas trying to establish the run.
Yeah, Ellsworth had a little bit of space there up the middle, but he stretched it out a little bit too wide there. Couldn't make the cut back into the middle, but still positive yardage, setting up a now a manageable third down.
And good play right there by Cody Mitchell, the safety. They run up in that hole in that lane and make a play and stop him in his tracks.
Hoyas need four here. Davidson showing blitz. Now plenty of time left on the play clock, so they could have changed the play. Maybe didn't. Hill's going to make the catch again. Justin still on his feet as he'll be brought down at the 40-yard line. But again, Justin Hill, the leader of this receiver group, and looking like it right there.
Yeah, Justin Hill, we mentioned earlier, is one of the players to kind of watch throughout the course of this game. Just a simple in route from him, not on this play, but on that last play, that third down conversion, just a simple in route from him. Barnes did a good job putting it on his numbers, and he made a good play.
Again, Hoyas going tempo here. Barnes looking over the middle. That'll be incomplete. A little bit of early contact, but the referees will let it go. A little four-on-four violence as Matt Buckman was the intended receiver, Jalen Mize, on the coverage.
Yeah, I thought Mize got there a little bit too early because that was a great route, great read, and excellent throw by Barnes. Because, again, when you're throwing over the middle of the field, you have to be confident in what you see, and he was confident. And it was just, I thought it was an early contact by the defensive back.
But the only judgment that matters is that referee. Ellsworth on the draw. He'll be hit and brought down across the 35-yard line. They'll spot him all the way down to the 33, so a nice gain in setting up a third manageable here.
Yeah, and this last play here just kind of shows you the versatility of Buckman. We just saw that last play running a go route down the middle of the field, a little bit overthrown, but getting down the field fast, showing off his speed. Now on that last play, he pulls around and lead blocks for his running back up in the middle of the front there. So just versatile player.
Rob Scarlatta yelling something to his offense. Don't know what yet. Keeper Barnes up the middle, still on his feet. He'll slide down smartly and avoid the big contact, but still gets first down yardage with the gain of six.
More like cannonballed right there on that dive. He got down pretty quickly. I don't blame him.
Now Rob Scarlatta yelling even faster. I think exhorting his team to go fast here. Barnes looks to throw now. Nothing there. He'll throw it up over the middle. That one's going to be picked off. So Barnes, with the mistake, they try and go fast. Play broke down, and he tried to go deep with it. Instead, throws it into coverage and gets picked off.
And that's one of those plays right there from Barnes that you see from an inexperienced quarterback. He did a really nice job in that last drive at stepping up in the pocket, knowing that he doesn't have anybody open downfield, and taking off with his legs. Here, he doesn't have much room to run, but now instead of not when you can't use your legs, now it's time to throw the ball away instead of trying to force something. So that's something that he'll learn throughout the course of the year, you know, knowing when to run, knowing when to throw the ball away and just take the down. So, an early mistake here for Barnes, but something that he'll use to grow upon.
And now they'll need their defense to step up right here, because now you have backed up offense if you're Davidson, but that's why it's good that they utilize two tight ends in the fullback, because they're apt to get out the situation.
Keelan Brown, the running back behind Mitchell. They'll hand it off to him. He cuts it back. He'll be hit and brought down on the play. Brian Jefferson getting a big arm out there to shut him down after a gain of one.
Yeah, right now it's just matchup football. It's just man versus man, big on big type blocking. Can you beat the guy in front of you? And you're going to see Davidson trying to lean on that defensive front seven of Georgetown. Now, if you're Georgetown, it's about hustle. It's about effort and want to. Can you get off a block and make a stop at or behind the line of scrimmage?
Davidson, two tight ends here. Brown, again up the middle. This time a little more positive gain as he'll get it out to the 10-yard line and set up a third and five here.
And this is a big third down here for this Hoya defense. They just had an offense, an inexperienced quarterback throw an interception down in that tight area. If they can get off the field right here, that gives Tim Barnes very little time to think about what just happened and time to move on onto the next series. So a big play here for the Hoya defense.
Cornelis back in the game for Davidson. Really had that good start. See if they utilize him here. Mitchell, quick pass, incomplete. Lockery on the coverage, and again, letting him play today as Derek Jones tried to make the diving catch. Lockery makes the good play. Might have had a hand on this back, but referees let it go.
Yeah, Lockery has been playing his tail off so far early on. Great job getting out in his drop and doing an excellent job of reaching around the receiver to make that play and kind of tugging away on the inside, but hey, no call, no harm, no foul, but great play, way to get off the field on third down if you're Georgetown.
So, this time, Davidson, different punter in there. This will be a rugby-style kick. As Vallis will scoop it up like a shortstop. Got a bit of a seam. He'll be cut down across the 40-yard line. That time, the punter on the play for Davidson. I believe that was Kevin Stipe. Now, player down on the field. Again, not listed in our notes, even in the top two punters, but maybe they're a rugby specialist kicker. And again, that tried to limit a bit of a return there. But again, the Hoya is in pretty good field position.
Really good field position here for this Hoya offense. And again, huge stop there for that Hoya defense, getting Tim Barnes now back on the field, getting that confidence going again, trying to figure out that rhythm again. So just a huge stop there for that defense.
And that's when your quarterback goes over to the defense and says, hey, thank you so much for getting the football back, bailing me out. Now we're going to repay you by going out there and putting points up on the board. You never had situations like that, did you, Mike?
Maybe once or twice.
Ryan Woods, the injured player, coming off. We apologize, folks. We ID some folks wrong. A lot of duplicate numbers on this Davidson team, so just kind of warning folks in advance.
It's strategery, they call it, right?
Yeah, it is. And of course,
never know who's out there.
And of course, it makes it tough on the coaching staff, so they can't be on the field for the same play, or it's a penalty against them. This time over the middle, Buckman with a nice catch as the linebacker got a hand in there, but Matt able to hang on for the first down.
Again, the versatility of Matt Buckman lining up in the slot there, just running a simple go route, simple vertical. Barnes did a really nice job here reading the defense, used that play fake to suck the linebackers up, and delivered a good throw to Buckman.
Great concentration, too. The guy flashed across his face. He was able to keep his eye on the ball and bring it in.
First and 10 for the Hoyas. Three receivers to the right. Again, quick pass to Buckman. This time, though, the hands betray Matt as he can't bring it in.
You know what that is? He saw an opening. He was going to make something happen after the catch, and that happens a lot to the best of the receivers that you see at every level, that you take you off the ball for a half a second, and you end up dropping it.
And Barnes was a little quick there on that fake, too, on the throw. He could have rode that down a little bit, given Matt more time to turn around, get his head turned around.
Barnes. Looking, completed to Williams. He'll drag the tackler down to the 10-yard line. And another first down completion of around 13 yards on the play. And again, Tim Barnes kind of getting that rhythm going.
Yeah, that was a big key here, just getting that rhythm back, getting the rhythm reestablished for Tim Barnes there after that interception. So good job so far delivering the football down the field.
Stacked receivers to the right with Vallis in the backfield. Alex will take the handoff, lunge forward. Pushes the pile, and they'll have a gain of around 4 on the play. And right now, Rob Scarlatta, again, he's the guy controlling the pace, it looks like. He's just jumping up and down, yelling. You're going pace, pace, go, go, go. And some movement there. And again, that is one of the things that can befall you, Michael. I know sometimes you go pace, it can work great, but sometimes you guys just get a little bit off track.
Yeah, and I was actually just about to mention that in my experience running the spread offense, we moved extremely fast when we were in the middle of the field. Once we got down to that tight red zone area, that's where you want to slow down. That's where you want to make sure that the play is right, make sure everybody's on the same note, on the same rhythm. And we saw it right there. Somebody was just a little bit off, and that's where you see mistakes happen in these spread offenses when they try and go too fast.
Look like both Nick Schweitzer and Buckman moved early. So now the Hoyas looking at second and 11 here. They can get a first down, and Vallis spinning forward. He'll gain 2 on the play, but it'll set up a 3rd and long here.
That almost looked like a Statue of Liberty play, a nice delayed draw right there by Georgetown. I like what I'm seeing from this passing game. I think this passing game looks a lot more crisp than what we saw last season as far as like the scheme and how they're getting multiple guys of football.
Timing as well. That was one thing that Coach Scarlatta really stressed, that Barnes gets rid of the football. That's what he's looking to do, and we'll see what he can do here. Davidson showing blitz. Barnes throwing the fade, looking for Buckman, and he overshoots his target. Can't bring it in, and Hoyas will be looking at a field goal opportunity here.
Now, although that pass wasn't completed, that was a good throw by Barnes. He put it in a position where it was either going to go out of bounds or his guy was going to catch it, and there was no chance for that defender to get involved in the play. So didn't get completed on that one, gave it just a little bit too much oomph to it, but still a good throw and something that he can build on.
And good job defensively by Davidson, not allowing the touchdown and forcing the field goal attempt.
Darmstadter with the 27-yard attempt. This one will get through the uprights, so the Hoyas get a field goal, add on to their lead. Now 10-0 on Davidson. And again, after that early dominance by Davidson, they missed the field goal, and really it's been Hoyas' game since.
And they've done it on both ends, offense, defense, now special teams. You see right here, great job getting the snap down and kicking it through. Knuckleball through it, but it got through nonetheless.
Darmstadter last year was 9-13 on field goals, extra points 27-27. And the interesting thing is most of his misses came from 40 yards and out. And I know, as us all being 3-year-old football players, it's one thing for your kicker to miss a 40-yarder. You say, hey, he might make it, he might not. But if your kicker is going to make the ones from 35 and in, I think you feel pretty confident in him at that point.
Points add up. You know, I don't care if they're 7 or 3, you need points to win the game. And so if you can hit those threes when you're called upon, that's just a win for your offense, because it just puts the defense or the opposing team in a situation where they're going to have to match your score.
Yeah, outside of the FBS level of football, it's hard to find good kickers because you can't really give them scholarships. A lot of kickers at this level are walk-on guys. So when you got a guy that's consistently making 35 yarders and in, You got yourself a pretty good kicker at this level.
It's one of the reasons that Darmstadter was second team All-Patriot League last year and preseason All-Patriot League this year. Ben Pretty with the kickoff now. This time looks like the wind is switched. Rowell's going to fumble this one into the end zone. And let's see. Should be a touchback. And it will be. So Davidson will get the ball on the 20-yard line. And again, though, good directional kick there by Pretty. I think you could tell that Rao, pretty good kick returner, was worried about his feet and staying in bounds.
Yeah, it's so tough to return kicks or field kicks or punts in windy situations because now your launch pad is off a little bit where you're trying to score up to get underneath that football. And at the last second, it changes because of a gust of wind. And now you're finding yourself what just happened on that play, the ball bouncing off your face mask or rolling the opposite way.
Yeah, Davidson actually caught a break there. He was going to catch that. If he had caught that ball, it was going to be about 1 yard from the line of scrimmage. He wasn't going to have a lot of room to run there. Probably going to get tackled within that 10-yard range. So definitely a good break for Davidson. Now let's see if this offense could come out and reestablish the momentum that they had early on in the game.
Looks like a new quarterback into the game. Stockton McGuire, the backup, getting some snaps here. McGuire looking deep, and he does not have a man as the man had a step as it was thrown to Williams Wicks, who went deep in the coverage there, Ramon Lyons, but just couldn't connect.
Yeah, we mentioned early in the pregame show that who's next if Taylor Mitchell can't perform or if he goes down. They have a freshman here in Stockton McGuire who was a record-setting 300-meter hurdle guy in prep school, also broke all sorts of records for them. So he's got some athleticism. He's got a big arm, as you just saw. We'll see if he can establish a rhythm throwing the football here.
I'm going to need for Wicks to run through that route right there and make a play for it.
And Wicks just a freshman. McGuire up the middle. He'll be hit and brought down. As looks like backup defensive end Mike Taylor in the game to make the sure tackle and limit the gain to about 3.
Here's a chess match that's going on between both coaching staffs. Right now, we haven't seen players cramp up, knock on wood, but the reason why is because we've seen a lot of substitutions. Week one, you normally see a lot of cramps, but guys are getting in and out. A lot of reps being had by both players, both teams. Depth charts are getting exhausted. So good job by the coaching staff getting everyone on the team some reps and getting guys fresh, keeping guys fresh.
Cornelius in the backfield as McGuire throws out in the flat, and getting the first down will be the wideout, Jarris Scott. Tackle had may have been made at first. I think he would have been short, but instead, Scott, a little stick-tutiveness, and ends up getting it past the sticks.
Yeah, you mentioned it right there, Jeremy. He would have been short had he been tackled here right away. Does a really nice job ducking his shoulder, just getting that outside spin move and getting the yards that he needed for that first down. So a great second effort there by Scott.
And he's their biggest receiver that caught his first touchdown pass in the 2015 season finale versus Stetson, a team that's in their the Pioneer League where they play. So good job getting him involved right now in the second quarter.
Stetson Hatters down in Florida. Bornelis trying to get to the outside, stays on his feet after the first tackle attempt, but he gets cleaned up. And I believe that was Jethro Francois coming up from his safety spot to make a big hit.
Yeah, that was Francois coming up and making the tackle, but that play was blown up there by number 48, Cameron Seward. Came off that edge there, forced the running back to bounce outside, and then his team rallied around. So a great job there by Seward, just kind of reading the play and forcing things outside.
And you hate those as a running back because you break two tackles and there's still more guys coming. You break those two more coming. It's like you're never going to get out that quagmire in that situation.
Davidson taking their time with coming up on 2 minutes to go in the half. McGuire up the middle, slides down after a nice gain. Let's throw it down to our Anna Tarullo on the sidelines.
Last time the offense came off the field for Georgetown, offensive lineman coach Brian Miller was really proud of his guys, telling them we're taking care of it out front. Now he just implores them to get a touchdown on this next series.
Thank you, Anna. So a third and 4 here. Davidson needs to get it to the 48-yard line for a first down, their own 48.
Big play here for the Hoya defense. Time running down on the clock here in the second quarter. Can they get their offense back out there?
McGuire looking deep. That's going to be caught and staying in bounds and going in for the touchdown is Jarris Scott. Looked like it was going to be an incompletion at first. Then it looked like it would be a catch. He somehow stayed in bounds and takes it the distance.
And now he caught his second touchdown pass and, in the last two games he's played. So great job staying alive. Again, you see guys that have height but don't play with that height. Here at 6'3", 194, he was able to go up top, get the football, bring it down, stay inbound, show a little bit of athleticism right there to turn all the way around and make the catch. And the speed to outrun the defensive back to the end zone.
And a good job there by McGuire making an adjustment on his deep throws. Now, he's not the starter, so he hasn't had a lot of work with these down-the-field throws with this first-team offense. On that first play we saw, overthrew his guy. Now this next play, he underthrows him just a little bit to make sure that he gives his guy a chance to make a play.
Smith on for the extra point. Boots that one through, and just like that, Davidson back in the game. Looked like the Hoyas were on the verge of blowing this one open a bit, but a big play there from McGuire to Scott, and now just a three-point lead for the Hoyas.
And you look at the defensive back right there for the Hoyas, kind of gave up on that play, thought the guy was out of bounds, thought the receiver was out of bounds, but that's why you have to play through the whistle. Until you hear that whistle blow, you got to stay active, you got to play through it. Otherwise, you'll give up touchdowns like we just saw.
Yeah, it definitely looked like once he caught that football, he thought the guy may have stepped out of bounds. He gave up on the play a little bit, and that's what allowed Scott right there. Maybe he thought he stepped out of bounds, gave up just that one step, and that's all it took for Scott to get into the end zone. But a really interesting move there by the Davidson coaching staff at pulling Taylor Mitchell, their experienced junior quarterback, putting in that freshman in McGuire, and McGuire repaid his coaches there on that drive.
They tell you don't flinch, man. When your opportunity comes, when your number is called, you gotta be ready to play. You practice with us all summer. You get out there, we expect you to make plays. And you look at a guy in Mitchell that was 12 for 12 in the first quarter, so it wasn't like he was playing terribly. It's just a changeup right here, and it paid off huge for a touchdown.
Smith also handles the kickoff duties for this Davidson squad, and back deep, your two running backs for the Hoyas and Vallis. As the ball goes off the tee, Vallis and Ellsworth. And again, interesting here, just under 90 seconds to go. Guys, I would think, depending on where this kickoff return goes to, depends on how Georgetown attacks this last 90 seconds.
Well, I think the big thing is the start of the drive. If they get down, pinned down within that 25-yard range, how do they start the drive? Do they start with something that's, you know, a draw play, a screen play? Can they get that 10-yard movement to then establish a rhythm? And that's when you see spread offense teams then say, okay, now we got a little bit of rhythm going. Let's push it through all the way to the end. So it really all starts with this kick. Where can they return the ball? And then we'll see what the offense does.
Smith with four touchbacks on the year out of his 28 kickoffs. High kick, but very returnable. He's going to push Ellsworth back to his own goal line. Isaac up the middle, shakes one man, can't shake a second. Nice play on the defensive end there on the special teams as James Gessner comes up and pins Georgetown inside their 20.
It's a good job right there by Gessner, because on one of the previous punt plays, he got de-cleated by Georgetown Hoyas, so he made up for it by coming down there and making a play, a big stick right before the half.
And now we're going to see how much confidence Coach Scarlatta has in Tim Barnes. Throughout the course of this half here, he's done a nice job establishing a rhythm, throwing the football. How much confidence does he have in him now, deep in their zone, to not turn the football over and get some positive yardage to set up this two-minute drive?
Late substitution on for Davidson. Remember, Hoyas will get the ball to start the second half. Let's see if that plays into the thinking here. Barnes looking for Harrell. I think he gets the hands underneath, and he'll have the first down on a gain of 17.
Nice stick throw right there, and the defensive back got there a little bit early again, but great concentration by the receiver to get down there and make the play.
And Coach just answered my question of how much confidence does he have in Tim Barnes.
A lot. At the 36, Barnes this time into Williams, went down to one knee to make the catch and kind of slaps the ball after the fact, knowing he had some more yardage.
Yeah, on that, you want to see him turn out and try to get toward the sideline to preserve that timeout.
So Hoyas, four wides, Butman one of them, with Vallis as the running back. Quick out. Harrell going to be brought down, I think, short of the sticks, too. So Hoyas got to take the timeout. Rob Scarlatta right there next to the line judge, making sure he gets the tight end as soon as they marked that one short of the sticks. He was taking that timeout.
And great tackle right there by Raul just to make sure he gets him inbounds where they have to burn that timeout.
Yeah, really nice job there, like you mentioned, actually making the tackle. A lot of times you see defenders there just push the guy out of bounds, which would have been detrimental to the Davidson defense there. So a really nice job knowing where he was on the field and making that tackle inbounds.
I mean, they don't put guys that don't have great football awareness on football game plans, preseason All-America team. So he did a great job there making that play in space. And again, now it's starting to become more of a chess match because you have 43 seconds left. No timeouts for Georgetown. Davidson has done a great job when they press up close to the line of scrimmage. How can they force these guys to dink and dunk their way down the field to run out the clock, essentially?
Yeah, I think the big key here moving forward for the rest of this drive is we alluded to earlier, Georgetown has a really good kicker. So they don't need a touchdown here. They just need enough yards to get him into range and give him a chance to put 3 points up on the board.
See where the Hoyas go. Seeing them isolating Brandon Williams away from the other two receivers a lot so far this game. He made a few big catches last year deep down the field. Wouldn't think Davidson would give that up. Now Hoy is just going to get the first down and more as Vallis has some room. Vallis could go all the way. He's got one man to be brought down from behind all the way down to the 5-yard line. What a call by the Hoyas.
Tremendous play call right there. Run that draw inside with Vallis and did a great job breaking tackles and was almost in the end zone. But now we're to the point where you have your playbook is open with 35 seconds left.
Just looking for the first down. Instead, they get a lot more. They take it all the way down to the 5-yard line, and Davidson, they've got to call a timeout. They don't want to get that quick touchdown against them.
Yeah, really good timeout there by Davidson, actually. They just had a big play happen. Vallis here breaking through on the draw and just taking it 50 yards for that run there, getting them within the 10-yard area, getting them into that tight red zone area. So now Davidson has to slow things down and realize, hey, we just need to stop the bleeding here. Get out of this with 3 points or less and do not let them get into the end zone.
And we talked about the chess match just a few seconds ago about the timeouts, and that was great by Coach Scarlatta pressing these guys to get to the line of scrimmage because he forced Davidson to make the timeout because the pressure really was on Georgetown. You know, the clock can start running, you have to make a play. And so great job right there.
Yeah, and that's the beautiful thing about the spread offense is you can get to the line of scrimmage extremely fast, line up extremely fast, which forces the defense to line up with you. But then you can completely stop, slow everything down, and get the right play call. So we see here just Vallis breaking through, great draw play call. And this kid is the horse of this running back group. He's the leader of the group, as we've seen throughout the course of the day, running extremely well for the Hoya offense. But like we were talking about, that's one of the beautiful things about the spread is you have to force your it forces the defense to line up quickly, which is why we saw Davidson take the timeout there, and a very smart timeout by that coaching staff.
Wouldn't surprise me here to see a run-pass option with Barnes.
So they'll spot it at the 6, first and goal, but just 30 seconds left. Barnes of the throwback, Buckman, and that will be brought down, and that is some very good film study there as coming back to make the play was the corner, Ryan League. Georgetown takes the timeout, and Emory, the reason I say film study is we saw Matt Buckman make a play on that exact play last year for a big touchdown. Someone from Davidson saw that, and they were right on the play.
Hey, good job right there, not taking the cheese, because normally in football, whether it's high school, college, or pro, no one covers a tight end inside the red zone. They're always wide open. Great job right there by Davidson.
And you see that play a lot in spread offense teams that have a versatile tight end. We did that when I was at Fordham in our spread offense. A lot of times in these tight red zone areas, you use the tight end to sneak out a little bit, pretend he's blocking, do those little rollouts, and then he sneaks out and nobody covers him. And that worked a lot for us at Fordham. I'm sure it's worked a lot here at Georgetown with Buckman. So a great job there by the Davidson defense at doing their film study, reading that play from the beginning and shutting it down early.
So the Hoyas have one timeout left here with 23 seconds remaining. So playbook is still open for the Hoyas, what they want to do here. But again, it's kind of changed the situation as they're looking at a second and goal, but all the way out almost at the 15-yard line.
Sprint right option, spider 2-wide banana are your favorite plays in this situation.
Yeah, I mean, Emory's got it right there. You want Tim Barnes to get out of the pocket and have that ability to run or throw the football. So we'll see what they do here.
Barnes fakes the handoff, throws over the middle. That one is going to be incomplete, but a flag goes down. Dangerous play there as Williams kind of stuck one hand up. But I think the reason for that may have been because the corner was arm-barring the other one.
What you call pass interference, some may call great defense.
It actually looked like also on that play that the center, Dom Scarangella, was downfield on that play, so you might have offsetting penalties here.
I think it may just be a penalty against the Hoyas because they're looking at the Davidson bench, and as you said, Mike.
Yeah, he was definitely downfield on that play. So we'll see if, yep.
So legal man downfield on the center, Scarangella.
Yeah, and you see this happen sometimes in those run pass plays. You know, the offensive line just wants to run block. And when they hear run, that's what they do. They get downfield and they try and get their guy. And then as soon as the quarterback pulls up the pass, you know, that's what puts them in tough situations.
This may be a benefit for Georgetown, too. Gives them a little bit more room.
Davidson again taking the penalty, forces them out to the 19-yard line. And Davidson going to take another timeout. And that's a tough one. Out of a penalty, had the clock stop. And Davidson unable to get their substitutions right. So maybe help the Hoyas out here. And again, that'll be their last timeout. And I believe the Hoyas, their last timeout as well.
This is an important play for Davidson here. As I alluded to earlier when they got down into the red zone, they just want to stop the bleeding. They want 3-0. So they're doing a good job here at forcing Georgetown to move backwards. Now this is a big play, second down. They're going to call two plays in the huddle here, kind of get everybody on the same page, make sure everybody's working together, and stop and keep Georgetown out of the end zone. So a good timeout there for Davidson.
You see Davidson in the preseason poll. They were picked to finish 11th in the Pioneer League. I think they're playing a lot better than what they're showing and than what this preseason poll shows. And that bodes well for Coach Nichols and his team moving forward. I mean, this is a very tough league. It's usually San Diego, Dayton, sometimes Butler and Jacksonville. But, you know, Davidson is trying to fight their way out of the cellar.
Of course, in the Patriot League, Georgetown ranked last, but I don't think that's indicative of where this Hoyas program thinks they're going to be by the end of the year. So second and goal, but from the 19-yard line, Hoyas do have one timeout. Throw it complete to Hill, trying to get down to the goal line. He'll be brought down short, but gets most of that yardage back. Hoyas, they're going to have to take a timeout, and they finally do. With 8 seconds left, we'll see if they add more time. Hill was trying to lunge forward, didn't get into the end zone, but gets it very close here, and now we'll have to depend on the mental acumen of Barnes here to make the smart play.
Yeah, they're doing a really nice job here using this play-action game to get Hill open and getting him into these one-on-one coverages, and Barnes is doing a really nice job at putting the ball on Hill, which is allowing him to then catch it cleanly and get up the field and make some plays. So Justin Hill's done a really nice job in this half so far. They're really leaning on him in the pass game, and he's making plays for him.
You got two big guys out there on the flanks, and they're showing why it's important to play with size. And Hill, he saw Raul staring down the gun barrel as far as getting ready to, you know, take away his midsection. He did a great job avoiding that hit and also catching the football, empowering his way down inside the 2-yard line.
And this is a big play here for both sides of the ball. Davidson wants to give up 3 points or less. This is a huge play. If Georgetown can get the ball in the end zone, now they're up even more.
No timeouts for the Hoyas. Has to be a touchdown or an incompletion before the clock runs out. Throw out in the flat. Harrell dives forward, and he gets in. Touchdown, Hoyas. Tim Barnes, they make the run-pass option there, but he throws it anyway as Harrell gets in for the score, and the Hoyas on the board just before the end of the half.
It looked like sprint right option to me.
Yeah, that was a great play call by the Hoya defense. I mean, you see Tim Barnes just use his speed to get the edge, and they use that guy in motion to outflank the defense. Barnes puts it on him. Beautiful throw on the run, leading his guy and giving him a chance to turn up. So a great drive there, a great final play for the Hoyas.
Yeah, if you're a defensive player, you want to expand a little bit when you see the guy flying in motion just to match with him, but you didn't. You stayed put, and now they gave him just enough space where he was able to release cleanly and get into the end zone.
In our conference call with Coach Scarlotta this week, he pointed out, you know, Justin Harrell being back is going to be big for our offense. Didn't play at all last year due to injury. First game of the season, he has a touchdown catch. Justin Hill has a touchdown catch. And you have to think those guys are loving playing together because of the fact that really teams aren't able to double one of them. They've got to really go after both.
Which opens things up for Matthew Buckman down the seam, in which we've seen him have a lot of success early in his game down the middle of the field. So if Georgetown is able to work every quadrant of the field in the passing game, then you're going to start to see their backfield pay, reap the benefits as well. So this offense is looking like a team that can really hurt you in multiple ways.
So Ben Pretty will tee this one up. Now the one issue here, again, they have to go ahead and have the holder there. And of course, holding an all game long is Jake Johnson. So we'll see, likely squib kick here.
Yeah, always one of the biggest questions in situations like this. Do you kick it deep or do you squib it?
And with 2 seconds left, and it will be the short squib right over the middle and diving on it, and the clock rolling, and they roll it out. And I guess that's going to be the end of the half, and it will be. So the Hoyas with the late score, and they're able to go ahead, find Harrell, and make it a 17-7 game. And the Hoyas, again, kind of got a little bit of an issue there at first. Looked like Davidson was getting back into the game, but instead the Hoyas able to go ahead and get the score. And again, good to see the Hoyas kind of finish this thing off strong, as they're able to go ahead and take the 10-point lead into the half. Head coach Rob Scarlotta about to join us. And let's throw it down to our Anna Tarullo with Coach Scarlotta.
Big score right before the half. What kind of momentum does that give your guys going into the locker room?
You know, it's big. We have to take care of our own game. In the second drive of the game, we had a drop and an offsides that was on us. So just want the kids to relax and play. That's a, I told you, Timmy Barnes, that's a big-time drive at the end of the half. So really happy to see that. Hopefully we can keep it going in the second half.
First half of the first game of the season is in the books. What did those first two quarters tell you about your team?
Same thing in every opener. Don't give up a deep ball and take care of the ball on offense. We'll clean that stuff up at halftime and we'll be fine in the second half.
Thank you, Coach.
Thank you, Ann, and thank you, Coach. Hoyas with momentum here at the half. They lead Davidson by 10. We'll have more on campusinsiders.com coming up after this. Welcome back to Cooper Field here on the campus of Georgetown University in Washington, D.C. The Hoyas leading this one 17-7 at the half against Davidson. Jeremy Huber, Michael Niebrick, and Emory Hunt back with you in the booth high above Cooper Field. And guys in this one. Really a good start for the Hoyas. It ended up being a good finish to the half. Hoya offense looked pretty good in those two drives.
Yeah, the Hoya offense found their rhythm after those first couple drives of the game. They established themselves in the line of scrimmage, running the football, and then Tim Barnes really settled down and delivered the football down the field extremely well with a lot of confidence. So Georgetown's offense found themselves a rhythm. Look for them to kind of build upon that in the second half here.
After the shaky start, the Hoya defense looked pretty good too, Emory.
Ready, stop the run first, and then he started to stop the pass, which is interesting because one, you usually stop the pass first, then you start to stop the run, but you have to like how well they're playing at each and every level.
Yeah, some really good highlights. Let's go ahead and take a look at them right now. Georgetown with a nice first half start as we see the ban for the Hoyas today, one of the local high schools. And, of course, first quarter highlights, we saw this Davidson squad. They started off back deep in their own territory, and the Hoyas, Javion Butler, shown well early.
Yeah, they did a really nice job stopping the run early, and they've done a nice job since of stopping the run and stopping the pass. Here in that first quarter, really just getting to the passer, getting to Taylor Mitchell, and causing disruptions in the pass game.
That was, again, Javion Butler with a nice play there, but Davidson would kind of get some rhythm going in the first half as this would get across and deep into Hoya's territory on the long completion, again, making it to the wide receiver. We had a really good first half, Braden Sims, but eventually you would see the Hoyas kind of stiffen a little bit. That time, guy again, Javion Butler.
They're just making play after play in space at versus the run, now versus the pass, forcing a field goal attempt in which they missed that opening.
Yeah, that one again, Davidson had a chance for the first score of the game, couldn't go ahead and get it done. So they would get the ball back, and then we'd see the Hoya defense again rise up.
And Butler once again making the play. We've called his name throughout the course of this first half.
Then into the second quarter, we would start to see some scoring. The Hoya offense would get it going. Again, the pass to Alex Valla is really working well today, Mike.
Yeah, and that was the drive that you really saw Tim Barnes kind of establish a rhythm, find all of his weapons out on the field, and ending there with a beautiful touchdown pass to Hill.
And Justin Hill with the first touchdown of the year for the Hoyas. Georgetown would kind of get the tempo going, and they would move down the field again. This time, though, the first real mistake of the game by Barnes, that pick.
Yeah, just an inexperienced mistake, and that's really all you can judge it up to. He'll learn as the season goes on to either run the ball or throw the ball away on plays like that.
But the Hoyas would come back down again, and Darmstadter would put it through for the field goal, make it 10-7. But then Davidson would find a way on this big play, Emory.
Yeah, playing with size and having size are two different things. We saw both in play on that one. You got to play through the whistle for Georgetown, but great way to answer the field goal by Georgetown for Davidson.
Jarris Scott with that long completion for the backup, Stockton McGuire. We'll see if he comes back out and starts the second half. Then the Hoyas late in the half, just trying to get the first down. They get much more.
Yeah, I mean, right before the drive, I asked you guys what kind of confidence they had in Tim Barnes on this two-minute drive, and they have a ton of confidence in him. And now this final drive, they got their running game really going in the big plays. And as we see here,
Alex Vallis with that previous play, and then the one you guys liked.
Yeah. Actually, this was one of those plays that Davidson did a really nice job at stopping, watching the film, and just knowing that that play was coming from Buckman.
And so they would get it down again. Hill would be the guy getting it down there. And then the play that you guys like so much, the old West Coast Bill Walsh staple, would be a big one for the Hoyas. They would find the end zone.
Yeah, sprint right option, man. Man in motion, easy outlet for him. Great read, great throw. Just got inside the foul line.
Justin Harrell able to go ahead and dive and get in. And that made it 17-7 with just 2 seconds left in the half. And that's the way we are now. Hoyas up by 10 on Davidson here at the half at Cooper Field. More football coming up on CampusInsiders.com. We'll be right back.
tonight, guys. So that's player to watch, number one. We need number three, Blue.
Georgetown leading Davidson 17-7 at the half. You're watching it on Patriot League Network on campusinsiders.com. We'll be back with more after this.
All right, so today we're at Towson University for the USA Football Developmental Games, a series of three games for USA Football, which is the youth arm of the NFL. We're going to use our drone today. We're going to do a flyover of the field so that we can run that in our broadcast as if like the NFL shows like a blimp aerial shot. So we're going to fly the drone today. You can look down here to my left. You'll see it's a small unmanned aerial vehicle. So simply just going to launch it now, and we're going to fly this bad boy over the field and have some fun.
Welcome back to Cooper Field here on the campus of Georgetown University. Georgetown with a lead right now on Davidson 17-7. Jeremy Huber, Michael Niebrick, and Emory Hunt back with you. And guys, again, really a nice performance by Georgetown in the first half. Really, Mike, you were talking about how I've been impressed with what the offense was able to show out there.
Yeah, I've been extremely impressed with the offense throughout that first half. I was talking to Emory off camera how they've established themselves in all facets of the offense. They have two wide receivers that have made big plays. They have a tight end that's made a big play. They have a running back who's made a big play. And Tim Barnes is leading the whole thing. So a really nice job with his offense kind of establishing themselves throughout the course of that first quarter and then really imposing their will in that second quarter.
And Emory, the defense, looking good as well, too.
Yeah, and I think the biggest thing that I took away from the first half is that they are stopping the run. That's what killed them on the opening drive. They stopped the run, they tightened up, and they made Davidson one-dimensional.
Let's go ahead right now, and we will take a quick look at, I believe, our defensive line play for this Georgetown team. And the Hoyas haven't looked too bad early on. Some good plays for the front seven.
Again, Javion Butler is a guy that's 6'2", 205, but you see him coming off the edge on the blitz. You saw him stack and shed a block at the line of scrimmage to make a play. You see right there, team defense. I'm going to funnel it outside to my help, and they're going to make the play.
Again, seeing more plays. Again, Butler's been all over the field, Michael.
Yeah, we've been calling Butler's name throughout the entire first half, so expect a lot more from him in that second half. And then here, you know, just, again, doing really good job in that read option game at finding who has the football and forcing them to make a play, forcing them to make a read early, and then the defense rallying around them.
The Hoya feeling strong just like that defensive line, and that's a big thing. You kind of look, really, the Hoyas have done a great job. They have more depth this year than they used it. I know you guys both remarked the fact that the Hoyas able to get a lot of, keep guys fresh because of the fact they've been able to rotate so many through. Of course, looking at the stats in the first half here, Hoyas really dominating in the run game, though on the passing side of things, Davidson not looking too bad.
And it's been an evenly played game. Again, a lot of those rush yards were taken away because of sacks, but you look at the fact that they stopped the run off after that second drive, or after that first drive, but everywhere else has been pretty even.
Yeah, one of the biggest stats I think taken out of that first half that's not on the screen here is the time of possession. Davidson has had the ball for 21 minutes. Georgetown had the ball for 5.5 minutes. So we'll see if Davidson comes out with that slow tempo offense and they keep pounding the ball with the running game if Georgetown's defense slowly starts to wear down throughout the course of the second half.
And the biggest part was 0-for-1 inside the red zone. We saw that missed field goal.
But of course, the question is, if you're Davidson, can you go ahead and do that, or do you have to change your philosophy a little bit in the second half? Because, again, it's only a 10-point lead, but you're down, and Georgetown, they're going to go ahead and get the ball to start the half. So it'll be interesting to see exactly what they're able to do. Again, if you're Davidson, you switch up what you're doing.
No, you don't switch anything up right now. You don't panic. Right now, you're in the locker room telling your guys that, hey, we just stick to our game plan. We have a whole half of football to play. But it's also going to depend a lot about what happens this very first drive. If Davidson can come out and stop Georgetown's offense, then they give the ball back right back to their offense, and they just do what they do. They run what they've been running, and hopefully, as the course of the game goes on, like I mentioned, they can slowly start to wear Georgetown down.
And you see these guys are down 10 points, but you're not down 10. You're down only 2 plays. It's just going to take you 2 plays to get right back in this game.
Let's get it down to our Anna Tarullo, standing by with the head coach of the Davidson Wildcats, Paul Nichols.
Pretty good things offensively. We got to capitalize when we have opportunities, and missed a field goal there, but overall, I'm pretty pleased with our offense. Really handled the ball and taking care of it. Made some big plays. Just got to do more of it.
What's the first thing you address with your team in the locker room at the half?
We're in a football game, and we got 30 more minutes, and it's about how we start this second half.
Thanks, Coach.
Thank you, Coach Nichols, and thank you, Anna. The team's warming up. Davidson already out here. Georgetown getting ready to come back out on the field. And, we talked about some of those stats. One of the things I did notice there, you guys addressed it a little bit, penalty yardage. We were kind of expecting more than that. Didn't see that much. So, again, the game maybe played a little bit better than we thought it would be for our first game. Talk about good first games. You got to like Tim Barnes, Michael. So far, 115, the 2 touchdowns, does have the pick, but he's looked exactly like a senior should look, even if he hasn't played that much.
Yeah, Tim Barnes has looked great throughout that first half, and you can tell that he's done a lot of just studying and taking those mental reps in those first 3 years that he was Kyle Nolan's backup. And he had the one mistake early, and that comes from, you know, he'll build upon that as he gets more and more experience, but definitely have to like what he's done throughout that first half.
And, of course, on the Davidson side of things, Emory, kind of almost two different offenses. You had the starter Mitchell out there doing one thing, then McGuire comes on and gets the really big play to Jarris Scott.
I mean, when you look at Stockton McGuire and Taylor Mitchell, they've thrown the football well. I mean, combined, these guys have 14 out of 16 with a touchdown. So the passing game is working for Davidson. I would expect them to come out and throw the football a little bit more in the second half.
We'll see if it's able to work for them as they're chasing 10. Georgetown leading Davidson 17-7. We'll have the second half coming up after this right here on the Patriot League Network and campusinsiders.com. Welcome back to Cooper Field, and there's the man of the hour right now, the quarterback for the Georgetown Hoyas, Tim Barnes. Of course, two touchdown passes and wearing the Joe Ekabachi Memorial jersey. And again, it's a little bit unsightly on the eyes to see a number 35 throwing the ball, but again, he is so worthy of that honor. Coach Scarlatta really talking about it, how really worthy of it he is. And again, we see the Ekabachi Memorial jersey recipient since 2003. Really good list of players there. Alex Busby, of course, one of the best players to come through on defense in Georgetown. Of course, Nick Alfieri a couple years ago, Joel Campella, the running back for the Hoyas last year, but a really cool living legacy for this award of Joe Ekabachi. Of course, if you're not familiar with the story, perished in the 9/11 terror attacks in New York. And, of course, a former Hoya football player, graduated in 1996, but, again, kind of keeping his memory alive by having this number out there. And, again, really something that, as a player at Georgetown, you are honored if you get that, and Barnes living up to that legacy so far.
Yeah, college football is a game built upon tradition, and if you don't have tradition in your program, you don't have anything. And it's great to see guys, you know, out here competing and wearing number 35 and doing things like that, which just adds to the value of your program.
So ready for the second half as the Hoyas will get the kickoff to start things off. Trevor Smith will boot it back deep for the Hoyas. Vallis and Ellsworth, squib kick. This one going into a dead spot. Someone's got to get on it. Actually, it's going to get out of bounds, and Isaac Ellsworth, a little more guts than I did. I thought that might stay in, but he knew perfectly that was going to go out of bounds, and that'll set up the Hoyas in some very good field position.
Well, we've seen two special team errors in this ball game for Davidson, the missed field goal and now coming out of the half, the kickoff going out of bounds, which is going to give Georgetown excellent field position. So it may not have been penalties, but miscues in play has plagued Davidson.
So the ball at the 35-yard line for Georgetown, where they will scrimmage first and 10. Again, Barnes, two touchdown passes in the first half. Now a little different look as Christian Bermudez in the game. He flanks one way, also into the game for the Hoyas, who will receive the handoff. No, it will be Barnes, will slide up and gets a gain of two on the play. Carl Thomas was into the game, so little new package in that contest for the Hoyas.
First time throughout the course of the game that we've seen two backs in the backfield here, so we'll see what kind of stuff they have that they can run from this package.
That was a great read right there by Barnes to keep the football and not sacrifice his tailback.
So now a little quick play change as everyone on the sidelines looks over, and Thomas and Bermudez stay in there. So a little new package for the Hoyas to go with to start the second half. A little bit more beef in there. Thomas up the middle, bang down across the 42-yard line. So it'll set up a third and short for the Hoyas. And you look at those weights on those two guys. Christian Bermudez checks in at 215, Carl Thomas at 202. So, again, a good size there for both those guys.
Yeah, definitely a bigger backfield that they're going with. Bermudez on those last two plays used more as a blocker than a runner. So we'll see if they use that throughout the course of the second half.
Shotgun. Thomas remains in there. Hoyas need two. Barnes to throw it. That'll be incomplete. Looking for Hill on that quick read option pass. And Davidson up to the challenge as they stop the Hoyas on third and short.
That was a great play by Ryan Leak. Again, when you're pressing the receivers, everything has to be perfect. The route, the pass, everything. And when you have to do that, it allows you as a defensive back then to make a play. Good job redirecting the receiver and getting your hands on him early allows you to be in position to knock that ball away.
So a vocal Davidson crowd expressing their excitement over that play. Darmstadt are on for a second punt of the game. Boy, is maybe changing something up. And now I'll blow this one dead, and I think Georgetown taking the delay of game, so maybe moving it back a little bit. So let's see if the 5 yards makes a difference, and I think what it will end up doing is Davidson was in their punt safe mode. Now they'll put their real return team out there.
Yeah, it was an interesting area of the field where you really don't know whether a fake's on. You know, it's one of those things that they could run it and be okay the way their defense is playing. So, safe play.
McCollum. Rao makes the catch. He'll be hit immediately. Stays on his feet, though. Eventually brought down. And actually, the man that laid the big hit is the one who's still on the ground, Matthew Deal. And he gets up, but looks like he's a little bit worse for wear as he put a big hit on there. But again, Emory, you pointed it out. Rao, not the size. And actually, he's down now as well, but not the size of a normal punt returner. And he can see some big collisions. We saw one there.
Man, when you had that size back to returning punts in a position where you have to be fearless regardless, and you're even more fearless when you have that size to protect yourself. But he ran up. That's always dangerous. Took the initial hit right there in his side, and then he got brought down by a gang of Ahoyas right there, and they try to strip the ball out. That's probably where he was a little bit banged up.
Well, I'll tell you what, if it was on that hit by Deal, he's about the toughest guy that I know, because he went and ran for another couple seconds after he got hit right in that kidney area.
Yeah, and you see right there favoring that part of his body. And again, he's probably going to go to the sideline and find a flak jacket or find a back flap to put on, because that went right in the back end as he tried to spin out of it. But kudos in for not dropping the football and able to get some positive play, yards out of that play.
Yeah, I think the next time he has that play happen, he might call for a fair catch on that one.
You're going to change it up a bit after you get stung.
So Rao will leave the field. It looks like he's okay. But again, such a key member of this team. 220-pound junior safety out of Woodstock, Georgia. So first and 10 for Davidson, and the backup will stay in the game. Stockton McGuire responsible for the one touchdown for Davidson in the first half. The long pass to Jarris Scott. This time, handoff up the middle. Staying on his feet and then hit by a host of Hoyas is the running back, Keelan Brown.
Yeah, we talked about Javion Butler in the first half and calling his name a lot, but we've also called Leo Lockery his name a lot, and he was involved on that play. He actually was the one that made the play and forced the running back to redirect to where a host of Hoyas was able to bring him down.
Yeah, Lockery's done a great job in the run game at coming up and filling those holes and not really giving the Davidson running backs anywhere to run.
Second and 7, we'll call it. McGuire going to look to run the option here. Dives forward, avoids the tackler as Brown got a piece of him. Lockery did too. He'll have a gain of 3 on the play.
Another great job there by Javion Butler reading that option. We've seen him a couple times throughout the course of this game really disrupting that option and not letting it kind of get out in space. So a great job there by Butler just kind of using his size and his athleticism to make a play.
And that's always tough. I always joke about how when you're the end man on the line and that option is coming your way, you're in no man's land. You want to take the pitch or you want to take the dive. He's able to play both, which is something that's unique, and he's able to stall it right there at the line of scrimmage.
Hoyas, four-man front, some pass rushers into the game. McGuire, a little bit of pressure, but able to make the completion all the way out to the 50-yard line, going high to bring it in Cam Chevron, and Davidson in business after that long completion.
And this is what we saw in the first quarter from Davidson. Nice, patient passing game. They took timely shots in the intermediate area you see right here. As Chevron does a great job running his route. Nice cut coming in between two defenders, and good throw, good placement, first down.
Yeah, McGuire did a really nice job on that play at letting the lower defender influence that linebacker, force him out, which opened that window for his wide receiver to get in behind him.
First and 10, just across the 50 for the Wildcats as they chase 10. Fake the handoff, McGuire, some pressure, hit by Sawicki. This one batted up in the air, had a chance for the interception. Ramon Lyons, flag is down, and Sawicki was bearing in on McGuire. We'll see what his penalty's on, but Brendan Sawicki got some good pressure there, and the flag will be a hold on Davidson, and Rob Scarlotta says go ahead and push it back.
Yeah, they went max protect right there. They kept all the tight ends in and tried to throw that running back wheel on the backside, but great heads-up play right there by Georgetown, not falling for it, but it would have got called back anyway because of the hold.
Yeah, and Davidson actually caught a break on that play. A freshman mistake there by McGuire, just throwing the ball up. He felt pressure in his face. He saw his guy out in the flat there, didn't think about what defenders were out there, and just threw it up. Could have been a costly interception. Instead, now they get new life here.
Yeah, first and 20, back at the 41. McGuire, quarterback keeper around the end, hit and brought down. Sawicki showing some good pursuit. Ball came out. Whose ball will this be as they're still fighting for it? They'll say Georgetown ball. So the keeper by the youngster McGuire, he gets hit, loses it, and the Hoyas come up with a big turnover here in the second half.
It's just a tough play. We've seen two turnovers in this ball game, one for each squad. But this is what Davidson couldn't have happen to them coming out of halftime. And great effort right there, getting the strip. We can't see the number right away, but good job as one guy held him up. The other guy came and stripped the ball off. That's how you coach it. That's great technique right there, and it's just a great job defensively.
Yeah, I'm not sure who got the strip on that one, but I know Captain David Akiri came out with the football. So just a great stop by the Hoya defense there, and we'll see if now their offense can come out and get a rhythm going.
So it was Akiri that stripped and recovered the fumbles.
So big play by the captain, putting his offense in good position here. Thomas takes it up the middle, gets tripped up by a stray arm, but still gets a gain of four on the play.
We saw the passing game for Georgetown get a lot of the pub in the first half. Now we're starting to see them rely a lot on the ground game, a lot of power running, a lot of lead plays, a lot of power plays, and they're trying to do a great job in establishing the line of scrimmage.
Hoya is getting a few new guys in the game. Jimmy McLaughlin in. Thomas tries to get to the outside and makes the mistake as he gets knocked down even deeper in the backfield. Loss of six on the play.
Yeah, and that might have been a bad read there by Tim Barnes. Let's see it on the replay here. Yeah, it was a tough play. The Davidson defense did a really nice job at filling those gaps, not really giving Tim Barnes somebody to read on that play, which forced him to just hand the ball off, and they got him behind the line of scrimmage. So good job by the Davidson defense.
And even worse news for the Hoyas. Looks like Thomas banged his shoulder when he went down. We'll have to see if he gets treated by the medical staff. Barnes looking at third and long over the middle, gets it to Vallis. He'll bang through a defender, and he'll be very close to first down yardage. Let's see. Depends on the spot. But Vallis with a nice play there. It looked like he was going to be stopped short and made it a close play. I think he may be just short of the sticks.
Yeah, Vallis and Roel, Raul, I'm sorry, for Davidson are two guys you don't want to go head up with. When they got a full head of steam, both can really bring the lumber.
Fourth and short. Hoya is going to push the pace here. Vallis up the middle. He'll have first down yardage. Gets shoved back at the last second, but he gets across the stick by a yard. Davidson coaching staff trying to say it wasn't, but Vallis gets the first. He'll come out. Ellsworth will come in.
Vallis has been extremely impressive throughout the course of this game, using his physicality and his speed throughout the line of scrimmage there and just making plays for this offense. So been very impressed with Vallis.
First and 10 here for the Hoyas. After the conversion attempt, fake the pass. Barnes looking deep. Does he have a man? He has Brandon Williams, and he has a touchdown.
That was a great job right there. Nice play call because he ran dual post. And that puts the safety in the bind because you have two going in the same direction. Whichever one he chooses will be the wrong decision. And Barnes stayed patient and found the open guy in the end zone.
Yeah, really nice job here by Tim Barnes. Just reading the defense, knowing exactly what you said. He's got two posts coming. The deep safety's in a bind. And he lets the ball go, lets his wide receiver run to it. Perfect throw, beautiful touchdown pass. And this offense has been really impressive so far.
Trusting the wide receiver, put that one up and through by Darmstadter. But again, we've seen Brandon Williams last year in his first year at Georgetown, not afraid to lay out for the ball. Made a couple big catches, I believe one in the Colgate game, one in the Fordham game. This time he makes a big catch there to give the Hoyas a 17-point lead.
And that's what's something I used to always pride myself on doing is laying out for passes. I wanted to show effort. I know a quarterback would definitely appreciate his receiver going the extra mile and laying out for that ball. And, again, when you have guys that are doing their job and doing it well, your offense will look like a well-oiled machine. I've been very impressed with what I've seen right now from Georgetown.
And just to add on, that now adds three wide receivers who have made a play for this Georgetown offense. So they're slowly establishing a wealth of playmakers on this offense that they're going to carry throughout the course of the season. So, you know, just again, just very impressed with how they've been playing so far throughout this game.
You see the All-Patriot League selections for the Hoyas. Mac Buckman, he really hasn't had a touchdown catch today. He has so many in the past, but I'm sure he would love to get one in there. Of course, Harry Darmstadter seen his good work at the kicking spot. Jethro Francois as well was an All-Patriot League selection for the Hoyas, and they Ken, it doesn't matter how many preseason selections you have, it's how many postseasons you have, and of course Mike knows that very well. But again, the Hoyas looking pretty good early on. And again, as you mentioned, Mike, those weapons at the wide receiver spot, Williams, another guy. He's a local kid out of local Power Northwest High School in Maryland out of Germantown, but really like what he can do, and he's got a good skill set.
I'm trying to figure out what happened to Taylor Mitchell for Davidson, and maybe it's an injury because we hadn't seen him since the freshman came in.
And we will see here Rao back out in the game, and he'll return this kick. Hit and brought down at the 20-yard line. So, again, nice special teams play. Blaze Brown there taking his legs out, and the Wildcats will scrimmage from just outside their 20. 33-yard touchdown pass by to Brandon Williams from Tim Barnes. Barnes' third of the day.
And it's not that he's throwing for 400-something yards. He's being efficient with the football. You would expect that from a senior quarterback.
Yeah, and Georgetown doesn't need Barnes to come out and throw for 500 yards a game. They need him to manage the game exactly like he's doing today and just lead his team down the field in each and every drive.
So McGuire still in the game. This one tipped at the line of scrimmage, almost caught and almost intercepted as Lyons was there just a little bit low. But again, the freshman McGuire stays in the game. Does look like, though, over there on the Davidson sidelines, we are seeing the starter Taylor Mitchell just holding his helmet. So it looks like this may just be a coaching decision.
And you want to see what worked in the first half for Davidson. It was those power formations, and they ran the football. Then Georgetown adjusted, stopped the run. Now can they answer by getting this passing game going?
Boy is showing blitz. They'll throw it out quick in the flat. Completed, but the Hoya defense, good pursuit once again to stop Jarris Scott after a minimal gain. Excuse me, that was not Jarris Scott, Isaiah Anthony on that grab.
Yeah, I think the biggest thing that we've seen with these two quarterbacks is early on they established themselves with those power formations. Mitchell was under center, you know, letting his running backs and his bigs up front do their thing. Since McGuire's come in, it's been all shotgun, all spread offense. So two completely different offenses when these guys are in the game. It'll be interesting to see as they move on which one the coaches like more and which one they think they can win with.
So Bornelas back in the game next to McGuire. Third and long here, going for the screen to Bornelas, trying to cut back, and Leo Lockery is right there to make the play. Again, the middle linebacker has been all over the field today. Right there, another example.
Well, we haven't seen Georgetown defensively be out of position on any play. Even on the touchdown pass, they were in position to make that play. So this is just great coaching, getting guys where they're supposed to be. They're reading and reacting, plant and drive on this screen pass and make the play, get through the trash, and bring the running back down for no gain.
Lockery with a great job to avoid those two linemen up front. So Hoyas maybe the chance to break this one open. Vallis back deep, another low snap, and the punter goes down to field it. And what a mistake, both on the snap and the punter there, going down to field it. Michael Matthews, he went to a knee, and that gives the Hoyas the ball just outside the Davidson 10-yard line.
Yeah, we're starting to see Davidson slowly start to make more and more mistakes. And we kind of mentioned it earlier, they've been out on the field a lot on defense, a lot on offense. Are they starting to lose it a little bit? Coaches need to get their guys back on the sideline right now, figure some things out, say, hey, listen, calm down. We got a lot of time left. But that was a big mistake there. Now Davidson's defense really needs to come up with a stop here.
I mean, you look at it. Mental mistakes become physical mistakes.
You know, it's not too hot out.
You get tired in the first game. I know it's the first live action, but you can't allow those mental errors to become physical ones that end up costing you points.
Barnes in Georgetown looking to punch this one in just outside the 10. Up the middle goes Bermudez. He'll be brought down after a gain of 5. Let's go ahead and send it down to Anna.
Now, it's not too hot out here today, but the heat does seem to be affecting wide receiver Justin Hill. He was just seated on the bench with a trainer massaging his left calf area. Unclear whether or not he'll be back, guys.
There by Justin Hill, the quick pass out in the flat, and Hill makes the big move to get it in for the score. And again, the Hoyas go fast, and it ends up paying off.
Yeah, I'll tell you what, Justin Hill has been extremely impressive today. He had a big season last year. I expected him to come into this game and make a lot of big plays, and I personally think he was snubbed on those preseason accolades. he's making a statement here today with a couple of touchdown catches now, some really big plays, and giving Barnes a really nice target to throw to.
And these Hoyas have been hitting the weight room in the offseason. You've seen a lot of guys break tackles today, and also guys on defense, when they make tackles, they're stopping players in their tracks. Guys are not getting extra yards after contact. So this has been an impressive display of strength by both sides of the ball for the Hoyas.
And down on the play, Jalen Mize, the starting safety for the Davidson Wildcats, and a little combo of, I think, some friendly fire and also a good hard-nosed run there by the wide receiver Hill, his second touchdown of the day. And, guys, you'd expect that a guy out of Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, might just be a little bit tough.
Right, exactly. I mean, especially when you look at his frame, because he's 6'2", 205. He's a lean guy, but he's solid, you know, so – you're not just going to run up on him and think you're going to knock off a wide receiver. He's a guy that can really put his shoulder down and plow you over. And you've seen this multiple times throughout the course of this game. Both receivers have done a great job in getting yards after contact because of how physical and how strong they are.
And I think one of the things I like about Hill the most is just to contrast that, on that last play, we saw him with a beautiful little shimmy move there to escape the defender. So not only is he a big physical guy that can lower his shoulder and get those extra yardage, but he also has the moves that are needed in that open field to get those big plays.
So Jalen Maya, good to see him coming off. But the Hoyas take quick advantage of that mistake on the punter going down to one knee to field the bad snap. Punch it in, and they've made it a 30-7 game with the extra point upcoming from Darmstadter.
And Mize has been playing his butt off as well, because he's been laying some lumber too. So both teams, I thought, have been playing some physical football in this ball game.
Snap and hold, kick is up, and the kick is good. So the lead now out to 31-7. Georgetown with a great start to the second half, two quick touchdowns, and they have kind of made what was a close game, especially if you figure in that last touchdown right before the half. Really a nip and tuck game. Hoya has three straight possessions, three straight touchdowns.
Yeah, they've kind of blown the top off of this game here. And that bad snap there for Davidson kind of sealed the deal, I think, for this game. As long as they keep playing well and not turning the football over, you know, this game's pretty much in the books. So now I want to see, from Davidson's standpoint, do they come out and fold, or do they keep going and build upon what they've done so far throughout this game to then get themselves ready for next week and for the rest of the season? So yeah, I'm really keeping an eye on Davidson, both offensively and defensively, to see what kind of mentality they have throughout the course of this game.
And you don't want to see a team panic. Again, you're down 24 points, essentially three possessions. You just got to stay within your game. Do what works best for you and try to slowly – you can't get it all back in one play. You know, they say the best way to eat an elephant is one bite at a time, you know, so don't try to come out and get 24 points right away, but you have to do something to start stringing together those positive plays like we mentioned in the open.
You saw those big plays by the Hoyas on the offensive end so far today, and they, again, have been pretty good since that opening struggles with Barnes. They've really taken it to Davidson since. Rao back deep. Takes it just inside the 5-yard line, looking for a big play. Instead, Hoyas again down there on special teams, able to go ahead and stop him in his tracks. That time, a couple guys from the Hoyas getting down there and making the stop.
And this is a tough position to put yourself in if you're Georgetown, because you have a lead, but you don't want to come out here and get laxed on defense and give up a quick touchdown, because that'll give the confidence right back to Davidson.
And I tell you guys, as an old defensive lineman myself, this is the time you love when you get to tee off on guys like you two, where you know you have a lead and you know you got to throw the ball a little bit. You're kind of pinning those ears back, as they say, and coming.
Yeah, and we're seeing Taylor Mitchell come back into the game here for this Davidson offense. So, you know, definitely a guy who has shown he can throw the ball a little bit more effective than McGuire. So that's definitely looking like what they're going to be doing here.
So Mitchell going to hand it off. Up the middle goes Brown, and he'll be banged down, but not until a gain of 5.
Nice positive play right there on first down if you're Davidson. Again, you want to string a couple of these together. And I think now you want to see them work with a little bit of pace, because under seven minutes left in the third quarter. You want to pick it up a little bit to try to get these yards in chunks via the pass.
Davidson got to start moving somewhat quickly soon as they're under 7 minutes to go here. Hoya showing blitz. Quick pass out in the flat. That'll have first down yardage. Is diving forward as Jones gets the gain of 8.
And this is what we saw early in the game. Nice, short, efficient passes, but enough to where Georgetown started to peel back a little bit, get on their heels, and Davidson marched the football down the field. So it makes you wonder what was the issue with Mitchell to where he wasn't in the game for a good portion of it, to where this passing game really couldn't flourish like it did in the first quarter.
Yeah, I'm with you, Barner. I don't know exactly what coach saw or what happened on the sideline that forced him to pull Mitchell, but definitely the more effective quarterback that we've seen so far.
Kind of a game that was a close one getting away from Davidson here. Brown takes it along the right end, slammed down by Kislik and a host of other Hoyas, but he'll still have a gain of 4. And, yeah, as you guys mentioned, really so far, I mean, kind of things were going well, but then those 3 straight touchdowns really kind of changed the tenor of this one, and, you know, maybe a long drive in between those might have helped them out.
And I still kind of feel that Davidson is not out of this ball game. You know, they have a chance to come back, and we've seen their offense be able to get yards in chunks with the passing game, and now we'll see if they continue to do so on this drive.
Pistol formation, Brown behind Mitchell. Looking deep. This is incomplete. Actually, he'll be picked off as Johnson down the sidelines has a caravan. Can he get in? He will. Jake Johnson to the house. Touchdown, Georgetown Hoyas, but a flag down. Let's see who this is on. But a nice play by Johnson. Not a great play by Davidson, and Johnson able to take it in, but let's await the call.
All right, you can scrap everything I just said on that previous play. Miscommunication right there by the quarterback and receiver. Receiver cut in, quarterback threw out, and it looked as if it was a pick 6, but we will see right here what the penalty is.
That's going to go against the Hoyas. So that will penalty be assessed from the 15-yard line. That'll move it back to the 25 as we see the play here.
Yeah, tough play for the Davidson offense there, but a great job there by Kisnick at forcing the pressure on Mitchell, which caused the bad throw. Yes, he probably was expecting his receiver to hang a little bit more outside. He hung it inside, but Kisnick was the one who got the pressure, forced him to make an early decision, and a great job there by the Hoya defense using that caravan to now get themselves down into good range to really seal the deal on this game.
Now you want to take your shot to the end zone on this play right after a turnover.
Barnes checking out that defense. Low snap, gets it back. He'll hand to Ellsworth. He'll be stacked up in the backfield. A lot of penetration there for Davidson, led by one of their linebackers coming up, Nate Casey, to get that first contact.
And now, if you're Rob Scarlatta in this situation, you want to see your offense absolutely impose their will and get into the end zone. These are the kinds of situations where teams who are going to be successful throughout the course of the year end the game right now. They don't give their opponent a chance to get back into it, and you can end it right now with a touchdown.
Christian Bermudez in the game next to Barnes. Christian up the middle, stays on his feet, spinning forward, and the big man able to get it down inside the 15-yard line and give him a first down.
You know what I like about this run? He lowered his shoulder and invited the contact. Like, you know what? You want to go head up? Let's go. Let's meet right in the hole. Let's have a physical discussion. And he was able to break a tackle and get it down inside the 20-yard line.
Bermudez out of the Bowles School in Jacksonville, Florida, I believe if my notes were right, won 1 state championship in high school, played in 3 more. So he's definitely knows something about winning football. Barnes throw. McLaughlin makes a nice catch on the back shoulder, just short of a score, but that'll make it first and goal for the Hoyas.
I'll tell you what, that was a beautiful throw there, right there by Tim Barnes. He knew that he wasn't going to be able to get over the top, threw it to that back shoulder, which gave McLaughlin a chance to turn around. As we see here, he knows he's not getting over top, throws it to that back shoulder, gives him a chance to make a play, and a great catch there by McLaughlin.
Little question from the sidelines. Barnes signals. Now he sees a lot of pressure coming. He'll give to Bermudez up the middle. Christian, I believe, stops short. Some good penetration there by Davidson once again. Nate Casey jumping in there.
Yeah, Casey once again has been playing some great football. He's made plays out in space. We see him attacking down close to the line of scrimmage and making plays. He's played a well of a game.
So again, Hoyas splitting out. Schweitzer into the game. Bermudez up the middle. Still no signal. And now he's in. Christian Bermudez into the end zone. His first collegiate touchdown, and the Hoyas have blown this one open with another score as they lead it 37-7.
And like I mentioned, if you're Coach Scarlatta, that's exactly what you wanted to see from your offense. They came out. They were efficient running the football. They did a good job throwing the football as well. And here Bermuda just using that brute force to get into the end zone. We saw it on a couple of plays throughout the course of that drive. Just a bigger running back who imposed his will on that drive. And now this offense has really shut the door on the Davidson sideline.
Darmstadter converts, and now a 31-point game. And, guys, you know, you have to talk about it. This game was a 10-7 game with literally seconds left in the first half. And ever since that touchdown by Barnes, the pass to Harrell, the Hoyas have owned this contest.
And they've owned the line of scrimmage because Davidson can't run the football anymore. And on the other side of the ball, Georgetown has established their ground game. They've been running the football very successfully in the second half. So it's about the line of scrimmage, and Georgetown now has done a good job in making it work. So great job right there by the Hoyas on both sides, owning up front.
Of course, the Hoyas not just doing a good job on the field, again, doing a great job in the classroom, highest APR in the Patriot League for the second consecutive season. 76 players named to the PL Academic Honor Roll in the past 2 years, and it's funny going through your prep on all these guys' bios. It just seems like every other guy or even more. It's all Patriot League Academic, all Patriot League Academic. Again, that is a good testament to Rob Scarlatta building a developing football program, but also his guys doing great things in the classroom.
Yeah, it's a big reason that a lot of players come here. You get a lot of really smart kids out of high school that come to this school because of the academic side of things. And that's why you see a lot of times that you have so many guys on the Patriot League All-Academic. So great job by Rob Scarlatta at really keeping them focused in the academic side of things.
He's building something special here in Georgetown.
That's going to go out of bounds, and I believe that was the backup kicker into the game. I believe taking that kick was Brad Hurst, the freshman kicker. So,
starting to see a lot of guys getting rotationed in defensively. Elijah English, who sang the national anthem. And I have to say, listen, if I had a choice between he and Whitney Houston's rendition, I would say he's pretty up there.
He did a really good job. And then he had to throw the helmet on and completely change the emotional right. side of things. You know, going from singing the national anthem to now, hey, let's put the helmet on and bang pads a little bit. So, you know, good job by him being able to do that.
English kind of in his element now, coming in as a situational pass rusher. Had just 3 tackles last year. 2 of them were sacks. Davidson still willing to go on the ground as Brown up the middle. He'll gain 2, but no more as he's stacked up by that front of the Hoyas. Hugh Masterson getting his arms around him, the senior out of Inverness, Illinois.
And we see McGuire back in the game taking over for Taylor Mitchell. And I think right now the coaching staff has realized, hey, this game's probably a little bit out of reach for what our offense does and how we've been playing. Now let's try and improve for the next game. Let's figure out, obviously, they have a little bit of a quarterback situation. Let's figure out who's going to play the best, who's going to give us the best chance to win next week. So almost a kind of audition right now for these quarterbacks.
Let's see what they do. 3 wides to the left, 1 to the right, tight end in the game as well. Mitchell, low snap again. This time just going to get what he can get. McGuire into the game as he'll end up getting 3 yards on the play out to the 40-yard line.
Yeah, good job there by McGuire. Just not panicking. You know, realizing it was a bad snap, it was a broken play, just getting up in the middle and getting what he could.
That's one of the things when you play in that Pioneer League, you get the non-conference, want to get some work in, so you're ready for that. Always so important in college football, winning that conference title. And same with Davidson here, as you said, kind of getting some play for both quarterbacks, seeing what they have. McGuire, pump fakes, looking deep. This one will be incomplete, but a flag goes down. Williamson was in coverage. The catch was made by Sims, but he couldn't get the feet down. Now the referees will talk about it. 3-man conference here, probably trying to figure out whether one was interfered with. Was it a catchable ball? What are they going to go with? And it looks like they're going to go with pass interference.
Yeah, Jelani Williamson was in great position to make a play. He just turned to the wrong way. He should have turned to the opposite side. That way he would have been in better position to make a play on the ball. I mean, he was able to pin him to the sideline. That's exactly what you want him to do. But if he turns the opposite way, it's not a penalty. It's a pass breakup.
So they will call pass interference against Williamson. Sims says he's coming off the field now as he took a tumble there trying to make that catch. So after it's all said and done, Davidson will scrimmage from the 45 of Georgetown. And again, Davidson trying to get something going here with McGuire in at quarterback. The freshman has the lone score of the game on his ledger for Davidson as he was able to go ahead and hook up for a long touchdown strike to Jarris Scott. 2 minutes to go in the third quarter here is Georgetown with a 31-point lead on Davidson in their opener. New running back in. Lunging forward, and that was the guy listed as the starter, Austin Wells, the junior out of Brentwood, Tennessee, gets four on the play.
Yeah, we haven't seen much of Austin Wells throughout the course of the game. Like you said, Jeremy, listed as the starter, so something must have happened throughout the course of the week, whether it be on the field, maybe he was nursing an injury. Something happened there that he hasn't really gotten much playing time today.
Yeah, Bornelas taking most of the action, but Wells in there now. Second and seven, we'll call it. Need to take it down to the 35-yard line for a first down. Quick pass out in the flat, wide open for first down. Yardage is the wide receiver, Cole Cheek. Should be Hunter Lothan on the catch, the tight end. So he will go ahead and get the first down. Yardage, let's throw it down to Anna on the sidelines.
Jethro Frankwell, absolutely confused with that pass interference call they called on number 26. He came back over to the sideline, arms wide open, looking down at his jersey, making sure that he was number 26. He didn't think that was it was on him. Guys.
Thank you, Anna. So, Davidson a first and 10 as the Wildcats trying to get their second score of the game as we dip under a minute to go here in the quarter. This one knocked away. Nice play in coverage there. Getting a hand on it for the Hoyas was Matthew Deal.
Yeah, great job there by Deal. Just floating back into coverage, reading McGuire's eyes. As we see here, he just floats back into coverage, reads his eyes, and makes a great play on the ball.
Yeah, that was a little bit of a predetermined throw right there by McGuire. He didn't necessarily wait until that window cleared before he got rid of the football.
And you see that a lot with younger quarterbacks is mm-hmm. You know, they don't have that rhythm. They don't have that experience. So they get the snap, and they immediately go straight to the receiver. And like you just said, Emory, that's what happened. And Deal did a good job of reading that.
So second 10, low snap again. But this time McGuire is going to pick it up. He'll be hit and brought down as, again, Sawicki showing some good pursuit to get there. He'll still have a gain of 7.
Yeah, this is a big third down here for Georgetown defense. I know Coach Scarlatta, they've put a lot of their backup guys in here trying to get them experience. But right now, you want to make a stop here. I know your backup guys are in, but you don't want to be giving up points with those guys. You want them to get out there, get their experience, but also continue to dominate the course of the game. So this is a big third down here right now for this Hoya defense.
Yeah, that expectation has to be the same no matter who's in the game. I expect you to get out there and get a stop.
There's one of the folks out there, Cameron Seward, the transfer from Boston College, 6'1", 220 junior, out of Atlanta, Georgia, whistles blow, and that will go ahead. Will it be a timeout or will it be the end of the quarter? Let's wait the official word. And they will take a timeout. So now the question is, how much time do they put? They'll put 1 second on the clock. So,
yeah, I didn't catch the play clock there. Yeah. I'm not sure if it was running out, but an interesting move there by the coach for Davidson.
You would hope, because they're going to need those timeouts if they're going to try and mount a comeback here. Use one there, but 1 second left on the play clock. And again, it's not like a situation where a weather-type situation, sometimes with a win, you want to get that last playoff with the wind at your back, but it's not the way it's looking right now. So let's see what Davidson can do. And, of course, one thing here I think is good is he gives Luke Thompson a chance to talk to his defense, who really done a very good job today, barring that one play on the sidelines.
Yeah, and again, it goes back to them, this being a big third down play. They have a lot of their backups in, and that was, you know, this timeout might have helped Georgetown a little bit more than it did Davidson here, being able to get their young guys together, figure out a game plan, and now go out and execute it.
I'd be wary of the tight end here on the little seam.
Yeah. Playing a man defense right now.
Hunter Lothan in at that tight end spot. McGuire Back to throw. First read not there. Throws over the middle. Hit as he throws. Ball's low. They say incomplete, but the Hoyas get the stop, though we think Davidson will probably be going for it on fourth down. We will see that play coming up after this. Hoyas leading by 31 here at Cooper Field. More coming up on Patriot League Network and CampusInsiders.com. Of course, you see the clouds in the sky, but they're not dark at all. Beautiful day here despite Hurricane Hermine. The forecast was supposed to be raining today, but kind of went out to the coast. And we've got a great day for football, and it's been a great day for Georgetown. They lead by 31, but Davidson looking to convert on a first down here. They get it here on fourth down. Again, guy who hurt the Hoyas earlier in the day, Bornelis, able to go ahead and get that swing pass to move the sticks.
And you like to see this if you're the Davidson coaching staff. You want to see your guys continue to compete on both sides of the football. Even though it is almost it's a little bit of a blowout right now, but you want to see your guys compete and continue to compete regardless of the score. So you like to see this kind of a drive if you're the Davidson coaching staff right now.
And this is a good matchup for them because in the Pioneer League, you got, again, San Diego, Butler, Jacksonville, all built the same. Like you see here at Georgetown.
So Brown's going to get the handoff. Looks to cut it up. Hit and brought down. Seward in on that tackle. Sawicki also jumping in on that play. So a gain all the way down here. The sticks. About a 9-yard gain. So just short. Of course, Davidson gets it. They'll be looking at a goal-to-go situation.
And that was a good job right there by McGuire to ride that fake as long as he could to where the running back was able to find a clear lane and get down inside the 10.
And that's what you have in McGuire, and that's what the coaching staff needs to figure out is what do they want their offensive identity to be. McGuire is a much better runner than Mitchell is, so do they want their identity to be that read option, or do they want to be a little bit more pro-style like they have with Mitchell?
Second and one. Brown hit in the backfield and brought down. Hunter Kislik still in the game and still making plays.
He's been making plays all day. We've called his name a bunch of times, and he just continues to go out there and do his job, and he's been extremely impressive throughout the course of this game.
And confidence is a fragile thing, and if you have it, it shows itself, and if you don't, you can see a guy instantly struggle. But with Kislik, we see him having success early on that just kind of carried him throughout the course of this game, getting off blocks, making tackles at or behind the line of scrimmage. He's played an outstanding game so far for the Hoyas.
So loss of two on the play. Sets up a third and three here. Again, Brown in the backfield next to McGuire. McGuire going to throw. This will be completed. First down yardage. Diving forward and in for the touchdown goes the tight end Hunter Lothan. So Hoyas kind of had the play diagnosed, but Lothan just too big and too strong as he gets into the end zone for the score.
Well, great job right there by Nothling, but Jelani Williamson, the cornerback, had an opportunity to help his teammate out and stop him at the goal line, but instead of not seeing what he hits, he came in and whiffed on that block, on that tackle attempt, which is why Davidson was able to get in for the touchdown.
And a great individual effort there as well.
Lothan able to get it in, and now Smith will come on for the extra point. It is up, and it is good. So Smith boots it through, and that'll cut the deficit down to 38-14. Still 13 minutes to go, so interesting to see how Rob Scarlatta plays this one. I think he would have to go with Barnes, keep him in there just to try and take some time down and wind this thing down. Again, the score is pretty good, but if you're the Hoyas, the one thing you don't want to do is to give a quick three and out, let Davidson keep that momentum.
Yeah, I think you got to keep Barnes in here, like you said, for one more series. Take some time off the clock. Even if it doesn't result in points, you have to take some time off the clock. You can't put in a backup right now. Go three and out. Give the ball right back to Davidson, the offense who just scored. The defense was out on the field for a while on that drive as well. So I think you definitely have to go with Barnes here just to get some first downs, take some time off the clock, possibly put up some points, but mostly, you know, the most important thing is taking that time off the clock.
Like, if you're going to substitute, you probably can go ahead and change out some running backs, some receivers. You want to keep that starting offensive line in because you're going to keep your starting quarterback in as well. But I do like how Georgetown can play multiple ways. We've seen them try to air it out. We've seen them just line up and play big boy football. So I think they have an opportunity here with 12 minutes and 30 seconds left to play whichever game they want to, whether it's quick passing or come out and just try to grind it out with those two big backs they have in the backfield.
So Smith with the kickoff. Ellsworth drifts back inside his own end zone, and he will stay in. And Vallis doing a great job to remind his fellow running back, don't go out. We'll take the touchback here.
That personal protector, as I always say, is the hater of the kickoff return committee. He never wants you to return the ball. He always wants you to stay in and get down.
If he's not catching the ball, he doesn't want to go out there and make a block.
Well, that will end up giving Georgetown field position at the 25-yard line. So, again, Vallis making the smart choice there. And really, we've seen all the Hoya running backs get some time today, and they've all done some pretty good things.
Yeah, they've all been very productive back there running the football, giving Barnes some blocks, throwing the football as well. So definitely it's probably one of their deepest positions that this Hoya offense has.
Saw that graphic last time the Hoyas scored 38 points in that big homecoming win over Lafayette last year. Ellsworth up the middle, hit and brought down as Davidson up to the challenge on that one, coming up from the defensive line spot, Ryan Samuels with the play.
Now, the biggest challenge that Georgetown has on their hands here now is, coming from a spread offense myself, when you go from playing three quarters of fast-paced offense and now you have to slow down and milk that play clock, that's where you start to see rhythm get disrupted a little bit because it's not used to what you're doing, and it makes it hard for the offense.
Barnes going to throw, has Williams with the completion and a first down, and I don't know if the defensive back slipped or Williams got away with a subtle push-off, but a big cushion there on really just a quick play.
And that was a long developing route because he kind of ran out and it came right back in. And it was the only option on that play for Barnes, and he was able to find him for a first down.
Tommy Jessen in the game for the Hoyas. McLaughlin will get the screen here and will be brought down for a loss as one of the DBs for the Davidson Wildcats, Ryan Woods, able to come up from his spot and make a play.
That's tough to do for a defensive back, to fly up in the alley, to break down, and then make a one-on-one tackle in space. So good job by Davidson making the play, and now you have it second and long, and that kind of limits what Georgetown can do right now offensively.
So really, kind of as you pointed out, Emory, some second-team wide receivers in there along with Williams. But the offensive line still the same, protecting their quarterback. Handoff, Ellsworth makes a nice move just to get out of the backfield and gets brought down after a gain of three, but that could have been much worse.
Yeah, and like you kind of just mentioned there, Emory, the offensive line staying intact. And as a former quarterback, it's my duty to point out that this offensive line has played fantastic for Tim Barnes. Haven't given up a sack all day. I really can't even remember a play where he had a lot of pressure in his face. So a fantastic job by that front five today, and something that Barnes is really going to enjoy having in front of him the rest of the year.
Davidson bringing pressure. Barnes gets rid of it. It'll be complete. McLaughlin makes the grab 3 yards past the sticks. And, again, we talk about confidence. Plenty of time to throw for Barnes, even on a blitz there, and he makes the play.
And Ryan Leak, the cornerback, was in position to make that play, but slipped, which gave the receiver that piece of window that he needed to make that play. But I tell you what, man, Davidson has improved a game as far as in the win-loss record each and every year. And I think Coach Nichols is building something great here with the Wildcats. And I think this team will compete hard in the Pioneer League this year.
This Georgetown team could do some special things too as Tommy Jessen takes the screen up across the 45-yard line of Davidson. Now everybody getting the ball, and it's funny, earlier in the game you mentioned a little bit, Michael, the fact that getting the ball out to different guys, and really the whole Hoya receiving corps has been involved today.
Yeah, it's a huge weapon for Tim Barnes to have, and that's why as this game has gone on, you have seen him become more and more comfortable in the pocket, having so many different weapons to go to. There's nobody that the defense can really single out, which gives a lot of opportunities for Barnes to throw the ball.
This one over the middle now. Schweitzer makes the grab across the 40 for 5 yards and a first down.
And one thing you see about this offense is that, you know, when you're able to spread the field to multiple targets, it goes from just a regulation football field to a Canadian football field. And if you didn't have that opportunity, it goes from a regular football field to an arena football field because your offense will shrink. So I like how they're forcing Davidson to defend every blade of grass. And that's just very tough to match up with or match up against if you're a defense.
Or every blade of turf as we are
turf,
today.
There we go, turf.
Under 10 minutes to go in this one. Ellsworth looking to bounce to the outside. He'll be bottled up. Gets it back to the line of scrimmage. So just trying to keep those chains moving and keep that clock moving, more importantly.
I'll tell you what, Coach Scarlato is really showing what kind of a mindset he has going in for this year. This is a situation where most teams want to bleed the clock, run the play clock all the way down to under 5 seconds, and then get a snap off. Coach Scarlato has his guys out there just playing football, running the offense like they've been running it all day, snapping the ball with 15 seconds on the play clock. He wants more points here, and I think that's why this team has played so well. They have adapted that kind of killer mentality.
Pass over the middle, complete to Williams, very close to the sticks, and I think he's just short. But yeah, it's interesting, guys. Another element of that, maybe he's trying to go ahead and cross train some of these backups and make sure they are ready to go when they're called upon, and making sure that it's not just the Harrell and Hill show, that all these other receivers can step in and do some big things.
Yeah, I think that could be a case as well. This Patriot League is very deep this year. There's a lot of really good defenses out there in this league, which could cause some injuries, and injuries are part of every football season. There's something you have to prepare for. So definitely giving his guys some good workout today.
Bermudez into the game. He'll take the handoff, and Christian bangs forward, and he'll be across the sticks for a 2-yard gain and a first down.
And both you guys are making great points because you want to establish depth amongst your roster. You want to keep guys involved in the game so they're not just kind of like just gazed and dozing off. But you also want to prepare for your conference because, let's be honest, I don't care where you pick a team preseason in the Patriot League, each one of these games will be close. We just saw Lafayette win last night, a big game against Central Connecticut State, blew those guys out. So now you look at Lafayette being better, Georgetown being better, and top to bottom, this will be a very tough league. So it's best you get your team ready to play.
First and 10 for the Hoyas as they look to bleed clock and maybe put another score in. Ellsworth around the end, hit and brought down near the 20-yard line. So Isaac with a gain of 4 on the play.
And I think, guys, just going off of that, you know, getting your guys more experience and getting them some time in actual real game situations. Last year, Kyle Nolan had Tim Barnes as a backup, a guy who's had some experience. He was a junior last year, got in a couple of games when Kyle Nolan went down. Who's going to be that guy this year? Right now, Clay Norris is the backup, but he hasn't gotten any time on the field. So this is a situation where you want to get that guy in the game, get him some real live experience.
Yeah, Norris has never played a collegiate snap. Barnes just throws that one away as he was trying to set up a screen pass to Williams, and it was covered completely, so just chucked out of bounds. And again, we've been looking for, Michael, some of the smart plays, some of the veteran plays, despite the fact a senior in Barnes hasn't played much. That's a veteran play right there.
Yeah, and you just saw improvement from that interception that he had. That was a play that he wanted to throw away and didn't, force it into coverage. This exact same play right here could have forced it, would have been a bad decision, but instead made the good decision, the veteran decision, to throw the ball away and live to play another down.
So three wides to the right, Williams all by himself to the left. Barnes, quick pass out to Jessen, who will be taken down for a loss on the play all the way back at the original line of scrimmage. So Hoyas will lose here, but the most important thing, they took some time off the clock, and they'll set up Darmstadter for a field goal attempt.
Yeah, good drive there. It did accomplish exactly what they wanted to. Whether they get points out of this or not, they bled the clock down. Now it'll be around 6 minutes when this kick's done. And just a great job there by the Hoya offense, executing just enough to, now they bled the clock, really took any kind of chance out of a comeback.
So Darmstadter will try from 41. Kick is up, and that kick will be no good. So gets blown away at the last second. That American flag whipping pretty good. So Darmstadter had the distance, but just couldn't put it between the pipes.
Yeah, hooked it to the left there, and as we're looking at the flag right now, that's exactly the way the wind's coming. So definitely had a lot of influence on that ball. He had the distance, but just didn't start it enough right and let the wind pull it back to the left.
Yeah, you got to like the distance on that for future reference. I mean,
yeah.
You know, that could have been an additional 10 yards that ball traveled.
Yeah,
so,
we talked about it earlier. You know, this is a kid who's consistent within that 35-yard range. Definitely has the range for a 45-yard kick, as we just saw. So, it's a big weapon for Georgetown to have.
So Davidson again goes back to work. Just over 6 minutes to go. Looking to add to their total. This will be complete, and this may be a touchdown. Again, getting into the open field and brought down inside the 10-yard line is Jarris Scott, as making a nice play to come up from the safety spot there for the Hoyas was Jalen Goldwire, but splitting the defense, and Davidson maybe not done yet.
You talk about a freshman making a big play, a senior play. Goldwire was able to chase that play down, but you also I like what I've seen so far by Jarris Scott. He's made two big plays in the passing game and just ran out of the gas right here at the end, but good job concentrating on the football and making the play and putting his team in position to put points up on the board.
So Davidson on the verge of a quick score and making this one still a game. This is tapped up in the air and will be picked off and maybe more. Still on his feet is Lyons. He gets tripped down. Now a flag will go down. I think he tripped over his teammate Javion Butler's foot, but Lyons makes the play. Let's see what the flag is on. I think this should be a clean pick, though.
And yeah, flags definitely came after the pick. Definitely going to be a clean pick. Looked like something happened there with blocking with Georgetown and actually blocking Stockton McGuire, the quarterback there. But we'll wait and see the call here.
So that will go on Davidson with the low tackle attempt, the shot block attempt. And so here's the replay, guys, and just kind of an ill-advised throw.
Yeah, it's a freshman mistake from a quarterback. He was trying to throw to his flat receiver there, but he was bracketed by two defenders. You know, definitely not a throw he should have made. Should have either used his legs to run into the end zone or thrown it away like we saw Barnes do a couple of plays ago. So a freshman mistake there that you don't want to see, especially late in the game when you had that big play. Getting a little bit of positivity with that offense.
Vallis back into the game after not seeing him for a while. He'll push forward and get a gain of 5 on the play out across the 35-yard line. Looks like, guys, on that play, what that was one of the Davidson players going into one of the Georgetown blockers attacking him low. And again, cleaning up some of those plays in college football, and that's what we believe the call was.
It was actually McGuire who tried to make the tackle, saw he had somebody in front of the guy who caught the football, tried to dive underneath of him, which obviously is something that's illegal in football these days.
Second and 5 here. Barnes still in the game as we dip under 5 minutes to go. Vallis takes the handoff, lunges forward, and on a first down yardage.
I tell you what, going back to that big play by Jarris Scott in the passing game for Davidson, how big was that tackle by Jalen Goldwire?
It's huge, absolutely huge. Because, I mean, you went from him completely could have just given up on the play.
Mm-hmm.
This game's over, could have given up. Instead, made the tackle, had him down on the 3-yard line, and then their defense comes up with a big play there. So, I mean, just a huge tackle by him and really set up that entire play.
Barnes in the gun. Vallis remains in. He'll take it off left tackle. Alex, nice run there to finish things off. Gets 9 on the play and back behind the play. A little extracurriculars there. Looks like one of the offensive linemen for the Hoyas. Maybe that's Nick Schweitzer. Was getting a nice block there on one of the defensive linemen for the Davidson Wildcats.
Well, this is the part of the game that you like as a running back because you're going to get all of the carries. You're going to get all of the yards. Your stat line is going to look outstanding at the end.
Ballas running into his own man in Schweitzer, but still ends up with a five-yard gain.
Now, if you're a receiver, you hate it because all you're going to be doing is blocking. You might as well put a 70 number on you out there on the flanks because they're not throwing the football anymore.
And I don't know about you guys, but I'm a little shocked right now that Ballas and these starting running backs, especially Barnes, are still in the game. Now, I know that these guys don't have a lot of experience, but this game's over. You got a brutal Patriot League schedule coming up. Get some guys in that aren't going to play much throughout the course of the year and keep these guys healthy.
Bermudez up the middle. He'll be hit and brought down. Ball comes out, but they blew it dead on the stop of forward progress. The one point I'll make on that, Mike, is that I wonder if that quick change may have switched things around where Rob Scarlatta was thinking, if they score here, I got to keep my starting quarterback in because it gets out of hand. Then when the quick change came, he said, I don't have my backup ready yet. I need to go talk to him, get him his mind right so he's ready to go in. That's maybe my theory on this, but it's interesting to see him still out there.
Yeah, it's a great point that you just made. Obviously, if they had scored there, Barnes would have had to stay in. You never know what will happen with Clay Norris coming in, having taken no snaps before. But right now would be a good situation to just kind of insert him into the game.
So Barnes, bad snap. He gets on top of it. Still loose, and they blow the play dead. And that is not a good call by the referees. I know they're going for safety first, but I don't think Tim Barnes ever had that ball.
That's the second play in a row you had a fast whistle because that was a fumble forced on that last play. And this one, quick whistle, wasn't a clear recovery. Davidson has to be upset with these quick whistles right here by the referee.
Yeah, Barnes absolutely did not have this ball in possession. We see the refs right now talking and meeting together. Maybe they'll overturn it. Maybe somebody saw something that the head judge didn't. But definitely a quick whistle on that last play.
And one thing I noticed, and we'll see if he does it again, Barnes at one point was kind of grabbing his hand.
Yeah.
And that's one of those issues. You don't get the quarterback out. You think, okay, we're just going to snap the ball. But in a shotgun formation, it's a little bit different than the center snap. Sometimes you have the potential for that. And referees will keep it with Georgetown here.
And still playing with his hand right now. Something happened on that last play that hurt his hand a little bit, diving after that football. And again, Clay Norris can come in right now and just hand the football off. It's not a hard task for him. So very confused why Tim Barnes still in the game.
Now this one, a quick pass out. Nice pass out there by Barnes. You hope it's just rug burn or something to that effect on the turf as he makes that completed pass out to Michael Darius. But it'll bring up a fourth down. So we'll see if Barnes comes over and gets some medical attention. But I would think that Clay Norris, if the Hoyas get the ball back, probably be coming in this game. But again, I don't think the Hoyas will see the ball again as we're under 90 seconds to go. As Hoyas done a good job of kind of running some clock.
And two tough breaks there for Davidson on that drive with both fumbles there on the quick whistles.
But you like that they competed hard throughout this past drive and not giving up. I mean, again, Coach Nichols has done a great job with his football team.
And McCollum dribbles into the end zone, so it will be the ball to the Davidson Wildcats on the 20-yard line with 1:02 left to go in this contest. Of course, upcoming schedule for Davidson. They've got Kentucky Wesleyan, I believe a Division II school coming up, Livingston. Then they start that tough Pioneer schedule, of course. One of the toughest parts about that, Emory, is the fact it's all the travel involved.
And I'll tell you what, they have a good chance of going 3-0 by the time they are 3-1 by the time they get to Stetson, which is a very tough team.
Of course, the Hoyas, they match up against Marist, had a good showing against them last year, then 2 weeks off before the homecoming matchup against Columbia, so they may look to build some wins up. The Davidson taking that ball around the end on the quarterback keeper. That time it was the QB Hunter Burns, the freshman.
That Marist game is going to be big time for Georgetown because I think Marist is another one of these squads that are built the same way that the Hoyas are. They're big up front on both sides of the ball, so it's going to be a physical game, and it's going to come down to which perimeter play can make the most plays in order to come away victorious.
So second, we'll call it 7 here for Davidson. They look to finish this one off strong. Again, quarterback keeper, and hit and stopped at the 20-yard line is Burns. And we'll see. They get one more playoff here if you're Davidson.
And that was a great job by Georgetown's defense to keep them in bounds to where you force the ref to blow the whistle, but the clock still has to run, and it burns some time in this ball game.
Seeing the third quarterback here for Davidson, the coaching staff over there has a tough decision to make. We saw some good things with Mitchell. We saw some good things with McGuire. So they got to really figure out here what they want to do moving forward.
Burns throws it out the flat, completed. First down yardage out across the 40-yard line. That completion to Khalil Shaw. That could be the last play of the game. We'll see what Davidson decides to do. If they'll run another one, they will wind the clock, and I think that will do it as the Hoyas will come out their first game of the season with a win. Georgetown looking pretty impressive as they get the 38-14 victory over this Davidson Wildcats team. And I think the most important part of this game was a great performance in his first start since 2013 for Tim Barnes.
Tim Barnes had a great day. Huge confidence booster moving forward. And I talked about it at the beginning how it was his time to shine. It was his time to take over from Kyle Nolan and really assert himself as the leader of the offense. And he did a great job with that today. Really looking forward to what he can do moving on throughout the course of the season.
And I was very impressed with the receiving core. I mean, they go now, I could legitimately say, six deep at wide receiver. And these guys can definitely make plays. And it forces you to expand the field.
Let's take a quick break here on the Patriot League Network and campusinsiders.com. Georgetown beats Davidson 38-14.
In the Patriot League, our playbooks look a little different. Here, we play to win in the field, in the classroom, and in the community. A competitive athletic experience with high academic standards. Today's scholar athlete, tomorrow's leaders. That's the Patriot League.
And welcome back. Georgetown with a 38-14 win over Davidson tonight, or this afternoon, I should say, as the Hoyas again with a pretty impressive performance as they were able to go ahead and get some big stuff from Tim Barnes. And again, four touchdown passes for Barnes today. Let's go ahead and hear from the head coach, Rob Scarlato.
They came up with a lot of big stops. What was working for them out there?
You know, Coach Thompson preaches all the time that it doesn't matter who it is, they're just going to play hard, running the ball. You know, the motto is wild dogs, and they did that today. Even when we made some mistakes, we chased it down and gave ourselves a chance at the end to come back and get some stops. So great effort, some things that we need to clean up on both sides of the ball, but that's typical for an opener.
Biggest takeaway from this game headed into practice this week?
You know, once you're up on somebody, you got to keep going. You know, we got up to 38-7, and I think we kind of let up a little bit, which we'll address during the week. But really, really happy to see Tim Morrison's first start come out strong and watch the whole defense. You know, there's probably about 15, 18 kids played on defense, so that was a big plus for us.
Thank you, Coach. Congratulations.
Thank you, Coach, and thank you, Anna. And, of course, let's take a look at the highlights and a good game for the Hoyas. Of course, they would start early on defense, Javion Butler.
Javion Butler was all over the field throughout the course of the day, making big plays, you know, throughout the first half and the second half. Again, we see another one there. So a big-time player really asserting himself on that defensive side today.
And you have to be excited if you're Coach Scarlato about what you're seeing from these guys at every level. Activity, aggressiveness, alertness. These guys are all playing great football. They're smart. There wasn't any busted plays, busted assignments on his defense at all.
And again, we would see the Hoyas defense stiffen when they needed to as they would end up getting the ball back. And again, Tim Barnes, his first touchdown pass.
Yeah, a huge first touchdown pass. Obviously something you really want to get under your belt early on if you're a relatively new starter throughout the course of the season. You know, made a rookie mistake here. Because this is only his second start, that's something that he's going to learn to do. And we saw him do it later on in the game, throwing the football away.
And we would see Darmstadter put this one through. But then Davidson will be able to go ahead and answer the freshman quarterback McGuire hitting Scott for the long pass.
Yeah, Jared Scott had a big day. Two huge receptions. One, he didn't get into the end zone. That one he did. Stayed in bounds, was able to pull away from the defender. But, you know, we saw some positives from Davidson and on both sides of the ball, which bodes well for the rest of their season.
Hoya is just looking to go ahead and get a first down here. Alex Vallis will get a lot more.
Yeah, right before the half year, this was a huge play by Alex Vallis. And like I kind of mentioned earlier, he is the workhorse of that running back group. A very deep group, but he is the guy. And then here, just the sprint out. Great job by Barnes. Knowing he had his guy open, setting his shoulders, getting a good throw out in front.
Barnes, of course, the guy there. And, of course, we send it to our Anna Tarullo.
QB, what's going through your mind right now?
I'm just so excited. Guys played great. The O-line gave me plenty of time to pass the ball. The running backs did a great job. Receivers were open, so it was pretty easy for me. Coaches had a great scheme in, so I'm so happy right now. We played great.
About 2 minutes left in the game, there was a fumbled snap, and you fell on your wrist a little bit funny. You came up shaking it. Is everything going on? What's happening there?
Yeah, I dropped the snap. The snap was fine. It was my fault. I dropped it. I was just trying to get on the ball. I landed on my wrist, my hand. I'm sure I'll be all right.
All right. Thank you, Tim. Congratulations.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Tim, and thank you, Anna. Of course, Tim will feature a big in our second half highlights as well. Again, he had a really good half, and he would keep it going with this long touchdown pass to Williams.
Yeah, and this was just a great play by him. He knew he had his guy, had the double post, had the guy, had the middle of the field safety crossed up. Just did a good job putting it out there for his wide receiver, and his wide receiver made a big play for him. So at that point, that was just, you know, the apex of his confidence that you saw throughout the day.
Akiri with that big play right there, he would strip and fumble, stopped a bit of a Davidson drive, then another play by Georgetown Emory as they would get a turnover here.
And when you're able to dominate up front at the second level and in the secondary, just a total team effort defensively, which is why Davidson only was able to put up 7 points in this ball game.
It was Jake Johnson able to go ahead and take that one in. It came back on a penalty. Later we would see Davidson come down. It would get a touchdown right there to kind of get the game a little bit closer early in the half. But the Hoyas, again, would be able to do some good things as they would kind of go on the defensive end, keep Davidson from really getting much going late in the game. We would see the long play here by Scott, again, kind of torching the Hoyas defense. Really, the two bad plays all game.
Man, but you look at the big play right there by the freshman coming in, making that game-saving, that touchdown-saving tackle, because on the ensuing play, it was an interception to kill a drive and ultimately win them the game.
And you love to see that if you're Coach Scarlatta, you know, second-team guys coming in and really giving a strong effort. Like I mentioned during the broadcast, he could have easily given up on that play. Let the guy score, game still would have been in hand, but a great individual effort by him.
There's an old saying, make him snap it again when you're a defender, and that's exactly what Goldwire did. It ended up being a good thing for the Hoyas. Our final stats in this one, we'll start with you, the QB, Mike. QB today, pretty good for the Hoyas.
Yeah, I mean, we've said it multiple times now how impressive Tim Barnes have been. You know, 75%, 220 yards and 4 touchdowns. This is not a guy that needs to go out each and every week and put up 400 yards passing. But he is a guy that needs to put up that 75% completion rating, a couple touchdowns here and there. That means that that offense is being effective and efficient driving down the field. And it all starts with Tim Barnes.
And Emory, you the old running back, you got to like Alex Vallis providing that run threat for the Hoyas.
And is this the balance that they have completely, because they go three deep in the backfield, and with the passing game now being efficient, and now you can run the football very well. I think when you look project into the Patriot League, this is what you have to do to be effective.
And we will see what the Hoyas can do, but they get off to a great start today with a 38-14 win over Davidson. So for my partners, Michael Niebrick and Emory Hunt, also for our sideline reporter, Anna Tarullo, and everyone that's brought you this broadcast, I'm Jeremy Huber. Goodbye from Cooper Field in Washington, D.C. Hoyas victorious to start the season. They beat Davidson 38-14. Good afternoon, everybody.